This is ESPN, the Total Sports Network.
For the past three springs, the NCAA Division I lacrosse title game has belonged exclusively to two teams. The Johns Hopkins Blue Jays and Syracuse Orangemen appeared again, headed for a fourth straight showdown, but 1986 was to be different. For the first time in 11 years, the number one and number two seeds will not meet for the national championship. In fact, both are out. Top seed and perennial power Johns Hopkins was the first to fall as upstart North Carolina did it to him in overtime. Then, in the other semifinal, Virginia out-muscled, out-fought Syracuse to make it an all-new and all-ACC championship. ESPN, the Total Sports Network, presents the 1986 NC2A Lacrosse Division I Championship Game. It's North Carolina 10-3 against Virginia at 12-2. Hello, everybody. My name is Greg Papa, working alongside Leif Elsmo. And Leif, this is not the way we figured it heading into the game. Two upset teams in the finals.
Absolutely, and it's great for lacrosse. Let me remind you that this is sort of a historical first Final Four for lacrosse, meaning that the semifinal teams were all on a neutral site. And two upset winners, as we've talked about, and it's the first time that's happened, that the one or two seed have not been in the finals since 1975. Hopkins has been here for nine straight years, so it's an exciting final. And both these teams, UVA and the great team from Carolina, are here primarily because of their defense. Great defensive teams, but also very talented and can score.
So far, the weekend has been perfect. The weather's been great. And we had two great semifinal matchups. We'll come back and preview Hopkins against North Carolina and look back on Virginia against Syracuse.
Painting your house? Any professional painter will tell you, if you want a beautiful finish that will last, the most important thing to do is properly prepare the surface. This could mean hours of hard work, scraping and sanding. Or you can do it the easy way with Restore-X Exterior Paint Remover. The remarkable paint remover that lets you rinse away layers of old weathered paint quickly and easily. Watch. The side of this house is coated with four layers of latex and oil-based paint. Simply apply Restore-X, wait, then lightly rub with a brush. Now rinse and watch Restore-X remove the old paint right before your eyes. Restore-X is great for window frames and moldings, railings, fascias, painted decks, fences, doors. So get Restore-X Exterior Paint Remover today and just rinse away old weathered paint.
Restore-X Exterior Paint Remover is available at True Value, Ace Hardware, Sherwin-Williams, and other fine stores.
North Carolina head coach Willie Scroggs admitted afterwards, Leif, that it was not pretty, but who cares? He beat Johns Hopkins, got himself into the finals, and they hung tough first three quarters by just picking their spots.
Yeah, I tell you, anytime you beat Johns Hopkins, it's not only pretty, it's beautiful. That team is loaded, and they're balanced from one end of the field to the other. Carolina came in not knowing what kind of game they're going to get out of their team. They definitely had a good defense, but they had to score a certain amount of goals to win. They wanted to keep the game low scoring. They did that. They controlled the tempo of the game, and the defense, again, was the key. They've got a great player in Tom Hoss, but they've got some guys who can also score, and here's one, Jim Kester.
He makes a great play, came right in off the sidelines, took this pass late, then made a good move to finish it off.
He came in like he knew something nobody else knew. He came around, ran right to the goal, drove left, came around for the right-handed shot. Very tough for Stuart Jones to stop that shot.
And then we knew coming into the game that if Carolina stood any chance of upsetting Hopkins, they would have to get a big game from their goalkeeper, Barney Aber.
Well, Barney Aber had a tough time the first time they met, 16-4. He didn't stop very many, but today he will have to stop a lot more, just like he did here. He looked right in the face of Dale Dressel on that shot, stuffed him, turned the ball away, and today we may see a lot more of that.
And then we got a kind of foreshadowing of things to come. Tomillo, who was held down the first half, makes a big assist here to a rushing defenseman for a big goal.
Well, here's your third-generation defenseman, Kevin Howes. He not only plays great defense, but he comes down and will take the opportunity to score. A great shot there. That can really defeat a team very easily, emotionally. Kevin Howes getting the score at a very important time for North Carolina.
It was an all-new Carolina team in that fourth quarter leap, and here Pat Welch completes his hat trick.
Look how nicely he sets up the defender. Fakes the right-handed shot, comes left-handed. He can go right or left. He's an All-American, one to watch today.
And here's the one they're going to save for the finals. It's Chapel Hill, Mike Tomillo on a great individual play by Gary Seibold.
Well, Seibold sets it up, beats DiTomaso coming down. Tomillo right in the right spot, waits for the goalie to commit himself, puts in the game-winning goal in overtime. We couldn't wait for any more excitement than that. That was tremendous. North Carolina right where they want to be against UVA today for the finals.
There's no doubt Carolina's pumped up, and Virginia will also be pumped up coming into today's championship game. They had a hard-fought, a tough physical game against Syracuse. They squeaked by him, and they earned their way in. We're going to come back and recap that Syracuse-Virginia game in a moment.
Imagine being on location with ESPN at events from around the world, places you dream about. Now you can be there when ESPN takes you on world tour. The next stop on the tour is the British Open. And your chance to be there with us in Scotland is your entry in the World Tour Sweepstakes. To enter, watch any of ESPN's golf events in May and June. Catch the World Tour winning slogan that will be announced during the event. Write it on a card with your name and address and mail to World Tour Sweepstakes, Post Office Box 1164, Ridgely, Maryland, 21683. That's World Tour Sweepstakes, Post Office Box 1164, Ridgely, Maryland, 21683. That entry will qualify you for the grand prize of a trip for two to the British Open. And it's only one stop on ESPN's World Tour.
And unfortunately, that's the weather picture for tonight.
Roger is a weatherman. He knows the difference between little storms and big storms. And recently, when he saw a big one coming, the first place he went was his Honda generator dealer.
Hey, you're the weatherman.
I need a real good generator.
And by the time the storm hit, Roger was prepared. The Honda generator, because you never know what the weather will bring.
There's probably not a whole lot I can say about drug abuse that hasn't been said before. You know drugs are killers. You know they can destroy a promising athletic career and ruin personal dreams and aspirations. So why haven't you learned to say no? I don't care if it's your friend or the big football player down the block who's offering you a chance to get high. Say no, that's all. Say no. And learn to feel comfortable saying it. It may just save your life. After all, you can't be a hit when you're high.
Something to think about from the NCAA.
Heading into the game, it appeared to be a matchup of the speed and quickness of the Syracuse Orangemen Leaf against the physicalness, the brutal strength of Virginia, and the game was just a banger's game.
Both teams are very hard-hitting. Virginia, of course, led by that great defense. They can also score. They have to win the game, but they have the least goals allowed on any team here. Let's take a look at some of the physical nature of the games that got this Virginia team here. This is Syracuse against Virginia. Scott Lynn, number 21, taking a lot of punishment from Syracuse, but Virginia refused to take the least part of it. They were banging all day long. And of course, that's why they're here today to face North Carolina.
And they're just a gigantic team. They can hit as well as be hit, and that's something you have to expect when you get to play physical style of lacrosse.
The defense is all tall, and they have a lot of good weight behind them. Here's Zalberti for Syracuse coming in against the great goalie, Sheehan. Look at the defense all around Sheehan helping him out. Sheehan looks right into the face of that score, kicked it up in the air. Now the defense helps him out to gain control, and once he's in the crease, then it's all Virginia. They take it back on the offense.
Well, Sheehan certainly was spectacular in the later stages of that game to preserve the win for Virginia, but equally as spectacular early in the game was these two guys, Marino picking for Nicholas, and Nicholas scores the hat trick.
Well, that pick move behind the goal is the key to their offense. You see Nicholas coming around, getting a step on the defense by using that pick by Marino. It was very effective yesterday, something that North Carolina will have to contend with today. That was a key score. Roddy Marino, one of the best attackmen ever for Virginia. Let's watch some of the contact he gets here, still maintaining control of the ball. You see Sheehan, 28, coming in. There's Todd Curry trying to get the ball. Believe me, he was trying to get the ball. That was actually a slash call. Roddy Marino, number 10 for Virginia, one of the keys to today's game.
Well, Curry didn't go near the ball. He hit him right squarely in the back and picked up a penalty for it. But Marino, undaunted, came back into the game. He took the pounding, he took the hitting, and he wound up with two goals on the day.
There again, that pick move. Nicholas comes in for Marino this time. Marino driving right, gets a step on his defender, as you can see. Then it's one-on-one against the goalie. He finds the mark to the right side of the goal. Again, something we can look for today to be a key to the offense for Virginia.
So it's two teams we did not expect to be here. Third-seeded Virginia and fifth-seeded North Carolina. First time ever two schools from the same conference will ever face off for the national championship. We'll come back with the first face-off today, and before the day is out, we're going to crown a brand-new lacrosse champion.
If you don't read the Wall Street Journal, you're saving a little time when you could be investing it.
Call 800-372-3000 for this special introductory offer. 13 weeks for just $29.50 with a money-back guarantee. 13 weeks, $29.50. Phone 800-372-3000 now for the Wall Street Journal.
When furniture has layers of ugly paint, use Formby's paint remover. But for old varnish, use Formby's furniture refinisher. An independent lab proved my paint remover is more powerful than other well-known brands, yet it won't raise the grain. Formby's furniture refinisher uses my special method to dissolve the ruined finish and reveal the wood's hidden beauty. So for paint, Formby's paint remover. And for varnish, Formby's furniture refinisher. For great results and guaranteed satisfaction, remember, there's only one Homer.
National pride is on the line when 24 countries compete for the World Cup Soccer Championship June 2nd through the 28th in Mexico City. ESPN brings you 15 exciting games, including the semifinals. Canada and the Soviet Union are among the top threats to the defending champion Italians. Be a part of the world's most popular sport. World Cup Soccer Championship begins with the Soviet Union taking on Hungary Monday at 2 Eastern, live only on ESPN.
Jim Ace Adams and his Virginia Cavaliers are all set to go. Ace, of course, is no stranger to championship rings. He won four himself as a player and four later on as a coach at Army. He's never won one here yet at Virginia. Of course, Willie Scroggs has won two championship rings back in 81 and 82. As we look at Jim Ace Adams, left side of your screen, across Member Hall of Fame. He's done it all in this game, and buried in there amongst his players, there's Willie Scroggs, the Johns Hopkins former player and an assistant there.
Greg, one thing we can look for right off the bat here is the all-important face-off. That has become a specialty in the game of lacrosse in 1986. Brad Wood is one of the best in the country for Virginia, and if he can command the face-offs against this North Carolina team, that will indeed take its toll against a Carolina team that needs to get ball possession.
Well, coming into the game, that's going to be a key factor because Carolina simply is not a very good face-off team, and Virginia is an outstanding one. As you mentioned, Brad Wood, a great face-off man. In fact, he grabbed 15 of a possible 26 face-offs in their semifinal win against Syracuse. So here we go. North Carolina wearing their Carolina blue.
Greg, that's Robbie Russell. Excuse me, that's Robbie Russell right there. We had him on the screen. He's a veteran for North Carolina. And Willie Scroggs is mixing up his players a little bit. Gets Teddy Brown out there to face off against Robbie Russell. But this Robbie Russell really shows the heart, and he really shows you the perfect player to represent North Carolina. He is a veteran. He's not tremendously skilled, but he's got a lot of heart.
Russell did not take a single face off in the semifinal game. It was Ted Brown doing it exclusively. Unless they had the guys face the wrong direction. Think they're a little nervous?
Referees were nervous, at least.
They've been playing a long time this year. They began it back in mid-February, and we're going to play 60 minutes for the entire season. That's Bobby Russell in the Carolina blue and Brad Wood. We're underway. Hope you enjoy this one.
As I say, watch for the wings to come in, Greg. They come in hard for the side. You got some long sticks men out there. There'll be a lot of pushing and shoving.
Now Russell going to grab his own face-off. And he clears. Good head of steam for Bobby Russell. He's a senior. Good shot, and early Sheehan makes a nice save.
Sounds like it might have hit the pipe, but again, the unexpected is the norm here at these playoffs. Robbie Russell winning the faceoff, bringing it down for North Carolina.
That's Brett Davey now giving it up. Now back to Davey, and he fires the ball wide, but Carolina had a player back there. They'll keep the ball and come at him again.
Let's take a look at the mismatch size-wise, Greg. The orange Virginia Cavaliers, Scott Lynn back there, they average about 6'2", 6'3", a tremendous size advantage over the 5'10", 5'11 attack for North Carolina.
And as we spoke during the pregame show, Leif, they use that size. They'll bang you all over the lot. Wearing number 19 today for Carolina is Mike Tomillo. He wore number 2 in the semifinal when he's the hero. Overtime goal that knocked out Johns Hopkins.
You can hear the goalie barking out the signals. That's Sheehan, the voice you hear. We might listen to him for a while. He's calling the defense.
Ball comes over to Bobby Russell. Russell with a cradle. Now we'll pull it back and drop it outside of the box.
Long sticks midfield for Virginia being very effective.
That's Kester wearing number 10 for Russell. He has a shot, and he lets it go. But Sheehan, who is playing some great lacrosse, now he gives it away and covers up. Boy, he almost gave him one there.
I was just about to say he was too casual, and too casual he was. He's lost the ball twice.
Here's Tomillo, and Sheehan again. Stones him cold. Boy, he comes out blazing.
That can hurt your offense. Three times in a row, North Carolina could have scored, but Sheehan, just as calmly as you please.
Now they come on the attack. Here's Chase Monroe. Across the field it goes. And Carolina gobbles up that ground ball nicely. Nice play there by getting back on D was Pat Welsh, the middie. There's Kester picking it up, trying to clear it. Nice pass into the front field. Rich Crawford, he scored a couple of goals against Hopkins in the semifinal. But all Carolina so far, here's Gary Seibold. Good pass. That's Welsh. Oh, Sheehan.
Sheehan is showing you, he is showing you what a first-team All-American looks like. He has made four point-blank saves. A couple of them he only owed himself the problem because he kept being a little bit too casual. But right here, Virginia, totally in command on defense. Watch how these long sticks defensemen bring the ball down and won't hesitate to shoot. Now they'll settle the ball down. Roddy Marino, one of the greatest ever in the attack into the field for Virginia. He'll run that attack for him.
32 goals. He's their top goal scorer, top point producer. Roddy Marino, last year, honorable mention All-American. He wears number 6. Throws behind his net to Jeff Nicklaus. They're the two leaders on their attack. Outside of the cage it goes now to Rosebro. And back to Engelkeep. Engelkeep began his career collegiately at Johns Hopkins before transferring here to Virginia. He played about 3 minutes and still no score. Now Nicklaus on the spin. And some great defense to smother him from behind there by Carolina. That was a great play by House.
Well, Tad Abram made a great, or not Tad, that's his older brother. Barney Abram made a great play coming out to stuff the play of the attackman who rolled inside the defender. Abram looking real sharp with his first try.
Engelke now throws. Near sideline for Gillen. Here's Nicklaus. He's dangerous in the spin moves. Back up top to Engelke. He'll run the show for the Cavaliers offense. Good move. Good shot. Just fired a wide.
You see Engelke set up for his right-hand shot. He doesn't like to go left. He was forced to go left by North Carolina as you hear the crowd disapproving the call of the referee. But Engelke, number 2, comes from a good stock of lacrosse players. Both his brothers were in the 82 World Team, and he's got representation there again in the 86 team. But he went for his left-hand shot. Not his best shot. Went low and wide of the goal. Here's Barney Abram calling the shots again for this clearing team.
He didn't have to make a save on that last blast, but he also had an outstanding game Saturday. Both these goalies come in playing pretty well.
Both teams noted for a very strong defense, and like in most sports, if you've got a good defense, normally you can compete in most games, and that's why they're here today.
Now we're going to see Abern kind of wander away from his cage a little bit. He has the ball on his stick there.
See what happens, the defense of the ride lets Abern bring it up high, then they'll collapse on the ball. It didn't work.
Nice pass to Cash Hilmer, and Crawford now goes behind the net.
Behind.
Now Crawford takes the return pass. That's Gary Seibold. Seibold being watched there by Scott Lynn. Nice pass inside. Shot is stuffed. Good Virginia defense. That's what's got him here. And Sheehan will try to run him out of trouble.
Scott Lynn made a nice play on Steve Huff. Huff was wide open. He should have had a better shot than that. He wishes he had that one back.
Schupler dropped the pass by Sheehan. Now Schupler's trying to get it back. Ted Brown battles, and Gary Seibold picks up for the Tar Heels in blue. Still no score.
One thing we learned in the semifinals is the ball does not leave the playing surface that often. This is a heavy grass field. The ball stays in play.
There's our first flag of the game. Scott Lynn just ripped away at the Carolina offensive player there.
The call is a holding call. He wrapped around from behind. Now watch this as he gets beat coming from behind. We got a good lend of it. Scott Lynn takes his hand off the stick with one hand, comes around Seibold. He could have called a number of penalties in that, including a slash. The call was holding, and what you don't want to do with a Gary Seibold is let him get that step on you. Just keep him in front of you. Keep good body position. His size, 5'7", 155, dictates that he will not beat you too many times one-on-one.
So the first man-up opportunity goes to Carolina, and they're going to squander it early here. Nice play by Breyer to take the ball away. Now he'll drop it back and kill some time. These are two outstanding defensive teams. Virginia gives up just 7 goals a game.
Sheehan using the crease as his offensive weapon, coming around it now, feeding onto his defense.
They're in no hurry to get across that midfield line, just trying to kill as much as they can.
Carolina, excellent job of riding. Look at 2 or 3 men on the Virginia players. That's Rich Reeder, their best middy, but he couldn't get it across. Virginia ragging him and doing a good job getting it back.
And the penalty has expired now. We're back at even sides. There's a break for Carolina now. And some good D again. Those Cavalier defenders are really stonewalling them inside.
Well, Shapinski came in on a fast break, and he looked like he was trying to feed the whole way in. He should have taken a shot. Nobody picked Shapinski up. The player stayed. It was a 3-on-2, but the defenseman stayed with their men. Shapinski didn't read that properly. He took the feed, which was totally covered, when he had a shot right in front of him. We've got a call down here on the field.
We got a holding call, I believe, on Virginia. Their second infraction of the game. It's on Sheehan. The goalkeeper, so they're going to go again. Ace Adams looks on intently as his team has to try and kill off another man-up try for North Carolina.
Actually, they're not man-up. What happened there, Greg, was the ball was on the ground. It was a loose ball situation, so they just got possession on that call.
Okay, so we are even sides.
See how they bring Seibold up top now? He has the ball up top. He came from the attack position. They've inverted him. He's up top now.
Here's Kester. He has a good shot, and he lets it go wide, and the ball rolls out of bounds.
That'll go to Virginia.
And we've played exactly 6 minutes so far, and we're still looking for our first goal of the championship game.
You want a TV? We've got TVs. Little TVs, big TVs, stereo TVs. Hey, wait.
Hold. Before you buy any TV, here's how to cut through the sales talk and buy smart.
I'm going to save you big bucks on your new car. Not 200. Not 300, not 400.
Before you get talked into any car, get the facts in your free Consumer Reports 1986 buying guide issue. Call now to get your copy, along with The Medicine Show, both free with your paid subscription to Consumer Reports, the magazine smart consumers turn to. Consumer Reports gives you the inside story on products and services, with ratings charts that show you how they performed and how they compared. Whether you're shopping for great sound or a sound investment, you can trust Consumer Reports. Call toll-free to receive 11 regular issues, plus your 2 free gifts. And as part of your subscription, the 1987 buying guide issue when published, all for just $16.
Call 1-800-544-1000. Alongside Lee Felsmo, Greg Papa, back in Newark, Delaware. Delaware Stadium. As Virginia tries to clear out, a little high pass for Lynn, but he's able to snag it down.
We talked about a defensive struggle. We looked for one. These two excellent defensive teams, Greg. We've had that so far. No score, 6 minutes. Watch this clearing by the long sticks midfield to Rich Rita. He's a great one for Virginia. He can score.
Third team All-American last year, Rita. Where's number 16 right there? Now he backs away from the box and leaves it for Ultimus. Behind the net for Nicholas. For Roddy Marino. Marino being watched by Chris Walker, number 42. Drops the ball, and he steps in the crease also, so the ball goes over to North Carolina. Good play by Chris Walker on a very dangerous Marino.
Well, good defense, but you know, we saw yesterday, or in the semifinals rather, Greg, we saw Virginia team using that pick behind, on the point behind the goal. They haven't done that yet today. They've been pretty much isolating one attackman or one defenseman. They might be better advised to go ahead and try that pick situation where Nicholas comes in for Marino and vice versa. They pick off the defenseman getting a step on him.
Well, the first six and a half, Leaf, have been pretty much the way we thought it would be. Very physical and some good defensive plays.
No question about it. Watch Barney Abram. They let him come up to the midfield line, hoping that they'll suck him into a situation where he won't be able to handle the ball that well. So far, it has not worked. It's a deep drop ride. It has not worked. Carolina, very little effort in throwing the ball.
Now, Bobby Russell, he drops it back for Brett Davey. Near sideline, Kester. Now, behind the net, that's Gary Seibold. Right in front, and a goal. That's a great pass by Seibold. He threw a beautiful pass. And Chris Galgano, number nine, the freshman, was there to stick it home. And that's now 16 goals on the year for Galgano, but this one was an easy one.
Watch Seibold looking left. They see Galgano break off the crease, and the defenseman didn't go with him. Galgano waits patiently for Seibold to see him. Seibold did. Left-handed shot, little or no angle, and he gets it. Now watch. Here's Seibold going left. Watch Galgano on the middle of the screen. He sneaks over. See that? No defenseman goes with him. Galgano waits patiently. Seibold, the great feeder that he is, finally sees him. Just like that, two passes, typical North Carolina style, make it the first lead of the game.
Well, Galgano's goal gives Carolina a 1-0 lead, and they've been firing away at Virginia. They've outshot them 7-1 so far in the game, and the one shot that Virginia let go was well wide.
Cannot leave this Carolina team alone. Guy Shipley had Galgano on the crease. He turned his back and was watching Seibold. You can't do that too long on North Carolina. They'll make that pass. That's what they want to do. One-on-one, they won't beat you. Making the pass, they will.
Now Virginia will come on the attack. The Cavaliers won the ACC championship this year as Nicholas drops the ball. Tremendous defense there by Tom House. Walker picks it up.
Greg, we saw that pick play on the back, just like we talked about. They set it up. It didn't quite work, but they went back to that. It was successful against Syracuse.
Now Walker rushes across the field. They clear easily. And North Carolina tries again. Brett Davey walks in and fires it wide. As he was also allowed to kind of roam in there too far on Sheehan and get him in the transition game, and he simply pumped it wide.
Good shot of Galgano here, calling the play, puts his hands up, he gets that offense up the way he wants it, coming from the bench, relayed into him, he calls the play from the back line. Now watch that offense get into some sort of pattern, cutting off the crease, looking to get a good feed.
Now we have a whistle before the inbounds. They're going to give the ball over to Virginia, it looks like.
I don't understand the call, and I'm looking down there at the referee trying to get it. But they're definitely giving it back to Virginia. That we know, as you see the transition, the players leaving the field. Long sticks midfield coming in for North Carolina.
So Scott Lynn, number 21 right there, a free-spirited guy. He dropped out of school last year after being an All-American in 84. We are now told that apparently he stepped on the field before he made the inbounds play. Reason for the turnover.
Told that by a guy who knows lacrosse pretty well. Bill Fitz, our producer, played for Philadelphia, and he knows and loves this game.
Now Virginia. Breaking across midfield, Roseborough. Will Roseborough. He's a junior out of Richmond, one of the few Cavaliers who actually grow up in the state. They really kind of looted New York State. 19 New Yorkers and 15 guys from Long Island on their squad.
Here's Engelke again. He really tries to decoy the fact that he's going for his right hand. He makes it look like he's going for his left, but the defender knows that he wants his right hand. Here he is, number two, out in front.
Patient Virginia Tech. Two guys to watch behind the net right now. Marino. Number six has the ball, and Nicholas, back to Nicholas now. Near sideline, it goes to Roseborough. Up top, here's a shot, it bounces over top of the cage as Gillen, the midfielder, stick in there and let one go. There's Barney Ayburn, who has yet to make a save in the game. They've let three shots go on him, and they've all sailed wide.
Good shot on Nicholas there. He had three goals against Syracuse, and Roy Simmons said Roddy Marino is great, but Nicholas scares him just as much.
There's Roseborough, number three, up top. Engelke, near sideline. Shot hit the post. Rattled off the post by Gillen, and it rolls all the way back near midfield. He cranked that thing right squarely off the far goalpost.
No question about it. And that was the one that Barney Aver just looked at. It went by him, and he loved to hear the pipe sound because that meant it didn't go back into the nets, but a great shot, great cannon shot from the outside.
Well, they finally beat Ayburn, but nothing to show for it. Engelke, number two. Here's Roseborough. Here's sideline. Again, this time Gillen scores.
Gillen,
no post got in the way that time. He's busted by him.
Tried once off the pipe high. He got it by Ayburn. It didn't quite work as he hit the pipe. This time he says, hey, I'll go with a bounce shot. They left him open again on the wing. Here goes, right across to him. Gillen takes it. Not yet. This is on the top of the pipe. He goes over to Gillen now. Gillen takes one step, sizes up Ayburn, and goes right down between his legs. You know that it had velocity because Ayburn saw it the whole way. It still made it between his legs. strictly on the velocity of the shot.
That's the eighth goal of the year scored by right there, John Gillen. He's a senior out of Pennsylvania. Injured most of the last two seasons. One of the quad captains for Jim Asad Adams. And he ties the game up right there. 1-1. We have 5:16 to play in the opening quarter. And Virginia grabs the faceoff, and they motor to the front field. This is David Grant, number 34, throwing for Roseboro. And he comes near sideline for Roddy Marino.
You see Marino slow the pace down, because what you don't see in the camera is that the substitutions are going on. The faceoff unit is coming off the field, the offensive unit onto the field. Now Virginia will crank up the offense.
Marino being watched by Walker. And Howes is checking Nicholas early in the game. Defensive alignment for Willie Scruggs. Engel key. Near sideline it goes for Gillen. He's the goal scorer so far for the Cavs. Number two, he fires wide, just missed it. And Walker grabbed that ball.
We can tell Gillen's not shy. He's gotten two good shots, one goal to show for it. He wants more.
Long pass by Walker. Near sideline for Ted Brown. Brown showing some speed. Moves by Roseboro. Behind the net for Calgano. Seibold, the pass to him, goes behind him. But Brett Davey picks up the loose ball, and Carolina comes again.
Watch out, Carolina. Every time they get the ball down on a break like that, they look to the crease. They always look to the crease, and the far side will be cutting through there. They love that transition game. They're very dangerous at it.
That's Pat Welch, number 26 for Brett Davey. Nice move by Davey, and he fired it wide. We're even 1-1, and we have just under 4 minutes to play in the quarter. NCAA National Championship on the line.
When a friend or a loved one is in the hospital, it can be scary. And sky-high health care costs only make matters worse. Unfortunately, Medicare isn't the complete solution, since it now covers less than half your health care costs. In fact, the Part A deductible that started at $40 is now $400. And your other in-hospital expenses have gone up proportionately. That's why I urge you to call Union Fidelity Life Insurance Company toll-free. You'll be sent a free information kit about a Medicare supplement insurance plan that matches Medicare's Part A deductible and copayments dollar for dollar. The rates are reasonable, and if you're 65 or over, you can't be turned down for any reason. So get the peace of mind you deserve. Call now.
Take Danny Thomas's advice and call for this important information today. Call toll-free 1-800-228-5955 or write to Danny Thomas, Trevose, PA 19049. Operators are standing by now.
Defensive struggle so far, Carolina and the Cavaliers looking up in this title game. Chris Calgano has the Tar Heels lone goal, the freshman. He throws for Seibold. Being watched by Lynn. And here comes Kester now. Cradling left, Kester now throws it behind the net for Seibold.
Greg, we haven't seen the reckless abandon that the Virginia defense played with against Syracuse. We'll see if they get loosened up here as the game progresses. They haven't been in the national championship in a while. Maybe a little bit tight, but yesterday they let it all out against Syracuse, and they just smothered that attack.
Pat Welch, number 26 today. And he has the ball taken right out of his stick. Great play by Bob Schupler. And here comes Virginia. Schupler. They're going to try and get a shot away, and they fire it just wide there as the blast was taken by Mike Meyer, and he bounced it a little too wide to Barney Aburn.
Well, it's a good play. Like any transition, basketball, or pick any sport, in transition, the defense can't get set. So when they push the ball off the field quickly, a shot that may not be all that powerful has a good chance of going in because the goalie's not set, and neither is the defense.
There's a good look at Roddy Marino out of Massapequa, New York. He's playing his last game as a Cavalier. Would love to make it a title game. Nice spin shot, and it went just wide there. Picked up by Nick Lestone. And back to Roddy Marino. We have 2.5 to play in the first 15 minutes of action here. 1-1. This is Rich Rita, number 16, and he had the ball banged away as he fired it and fired it near the sideline out of bounds.
Kevin Hollis had a great defensive play against Rich Rita. Rich Rita very strong to his right-hand side. He drove in there, and Hollis didn't have quite the position he wanted to have, but he got enough of stick on there, enough bothering position-wise, that Rich Rita's shot was a little bit off of the 6x6 goal. Now setting up the clear. What happens to Greg is we bring that midfielder down here that can handle the ball so well. He comes down deep sort of to help out those long stick defensemen. Gives it back to the goalie so he can sort of call the play.
Aber now going to wander again from his cage. He didn't do much of this in the semifinal game against Hopkins.
Virginia constantly now letting him come up to the midfield line, but if they do that, they should play everybody else tough. The clear has been way too easy for North Carolina, and Virginia's going to have to rectify that.
James Kester now, number 10. Tries to come left sideline after circling. That nice pass out front to Russell was blocked by Virginia's defense. Ball squirts back for Crawford.
Sheehan's out of the goal right now. If they get a shot, he's not in there.
Wide open net. Oh, he got back in and stuffed Russell. And he makes a great outlet pass. What a play by Sheehan. Here comes Virginia. Beeger. And he was stuffed by House. Great lacrosse action right there.
They're running now, but Beeger, look at that. Roddy Barino going down, playing defense now. He knows that he had to get back down to play against the midfielder. I think they're offside. There's the flag. They're actually offside. A free shot for North Carolina.
Virginia offside, so Carolina will come at him. This is Welsh. Bounces it. Good shot, but it bounced just wide of the cage there.
What happened was Roddy Marino saw the fast break. Even though he's an attackman, he can go ahead and go down and play midfield to prevent that fast break. But the defenseman that was down there has to maintain that positioning. Here's Ace Adams a little bit disconsolate because that team, the penalty was going to cause his team now to be a man down. So to protect that situation, Roddy Marino actually came down and gave his team a penalty. Now they'll be a man down for a short period of time.
So the penalty against Virginia will give North Carolina their second man-up try of the game. And this is Welsh. Big shot, and Sheehan has been just tremendous today as he again robs the shot there by North Carolina. That was John Stahl who fired it away, but Sheehan was there.
Sheehan looks oh so tough, and I tell you, you can tell the great goalies when they don't look like they're putting out any effort to stop those great shots.
John Shapinski, number 12 for Carolina. Freshman, good goal scorer for Bobby Russell. Welsh trying to sneak it through, but it was stuffed inside. Scramble is on, and Seinfeld couldn't quite corral the loose ball there. Ball's going to roll out of bounds. No, saved nicely. He actually did go out of bounds. Shapinski could not keep it in.
35 seconds left, Greg. Not much time. A very low-scoring game. 1-1, and this quarter just about history.
Low-scoring, but certainly these two teams have had their chances to pile up some goals, but Sheehan has stonewalled Carolina, and Virginia has fired wide on Aberin.
I was amazed that Beeger took the ball down that fast break last time and looked to feed it off. The guy has 9 goals. He's a great transition long stick defenseman, and in most cases he's going to shoot in that situation.
Sheehan takes the return pass. We have Sheehan now for 7 first quarter saves. He had 8 of his 11 saves Saturday against Syracuse in the second half, so he's a hot goalie right now. They're going to make Rita turn back and give it up. Now they come to the front field. A sloppy pass there as Frank Smith could not catch the ball far sideline. With 15 seconds to go, Willie Scroggs has a shot to diagram a play for one last go round.
That was a pretty tough mistake because they do have time to get a shot off, and Virginia, all they had to do is kill the time to get out of the quarter.
That's Frank Smith, who did not corral the pass, just came into the game, the junior from Freeport, New York. He gives Carolina one last shot. 10 seconds to play in the quarter, 1-1 tie. Kester, he's got good speed. To Seibold, 5 seconds. 4, he shoots and Sheehan makes an easy save. And that will run out the first quarter. It was the Peter Sheehan show in that first quarter. He made 8-9 saves, and we're 1-1 at the end of the first 15 minutes in the NCAA title game.
So, what's the mystery to your great-looking hair?
Simple. I don't use a regular shampoo.
What is it?
It's Head and Shoulders. It's everything I want for my hair, and more.
Mind if I try it? Catch.
Its dandruff protection works on your scalp, not your hair. Gentle conditioners go there.
This is great hair. And a great way to forget about dandruff. Mm.
Today's Head and Shoulders. Dandruff care that's good for your hair.
I've never seen nothing like it. Landed over that hill, moved around some, and then just jumped up. They all have this one big eye, and they make this humming sound.
Introducing the Honda Fan Cam. It's got an electric starter and no clutch, so it's easy to ride. And when it comes to fun, there's nothing like it on Earth.
They come from Mars.
I don't need this from out of town.
The Fat Cat. It's a whole new animal. Oh,
Just because you've washed your car doesn't mean you're finished. After each wash, you need some Armor All. On the dash, the bumper, and especially the tires. After all, when you're in love, what's a few extra minutes? Armor All. It's the finishing touch every time you wash your car.
Who says you can't have it all? Who says you can't love your work and the change of pay? Who says you can't have light beer with super premium taste? Michelob Light.
Oh, yes, you can.
Michelob Light.
Oh, yes, you can.
Super premium taste and a less filling beer.
Yes, you can.
Have it all. Jim Ace Adams. Boy, he's done it all in this game. One of the great players. You know, when he played high school and college lacrosse, he didn't lose a single game. Four high school seasons unbeaten. Four lacrosse seasons unbeaten at Johns Hopkins. And his four titles as a coach at Army.
His picture hangs in the Hall of Fame of the Lacrosse Hall of Fame at Johns Hopkins campus. And well deserved. The guy really knows the game from one end to the other. He's had great success. This team right here, here's Willie Sprock, another guy who has great success. A tutor of the actual Hopkins system, played at Hopkins, coached down there, and has had some tremendous success in North Carolina. These guys deserve to be here, and they're here for good reason, obviously.
Sprock's trying to win his third NCAA championship as a Tar Heel coach, and that would equal Johns Hopkins' three titles in the decade of the 80s, the two most successful teams, if Carolina can do it. Two squads now going to switch sides. They played 1-1 at the end of the first quarter. And a big face-off again. Brad Wood will face it off against Ted Brown. And Brad Wood, the specialist for Virginia, wins it. Takes a punishing blow for winning and to give him the ball right back.
Well, North Carolina is all over. They don't match up size-wise, but they're all over Virginia.
Crawford for Gary Seivold. Seivold going to feather one up top. Streaking in is Pat Welsh. Lost it for a moment, retakes it. Here's Seivold with a little area, but Sheehan stones him again.
They're going to call him into the crease, Seivold, but talk about opportunistic. That's Gary Seivold for you. There was a foot race coming in from the substitution box. Seivold made the initial feed to the man coming in who had a step on the man for substitution. And we'll take a look from that last faceoff. Look at that. Brad Wood got the faceoff, but North Carolina is all over him, double-teamed, and that made the pass go awry. Even though he got the faceoff, that hustle by North Carolina brought the ball back.
Well, that was Mike Tomillo who really stuck him from behind and made him cough that ball up. Faceoffs in the first quarter, Virginia won two of the three, and they've now won three of the four. Ball does stay in play, just barely. Didn't step out before he gave it up. Now Tom Howes of North Carolina trying to corral it. Marino going to beat him to it, though. Walker's hounding him from behind.
The one thing I've missed for Virginia so far, Greg, is that the tempo of their game is really dictated by the defense. The long sticks guys have to come out with a little more aggression like they did against Syracuse and start getting the whole team going at a higher level of intensity. It starts with their defense at Virginia.
Marino gonna attack Walker, but Walker stops him. Now Marino comes up. Big shot by Rita. Goal! Virginia goes on top 2-1. Rich Rita, senior. Scores goal number 16 of the year on a good bounce shot by Ahern.
Well, Rich Rita is very strong up top, and this is where you don't want him to get the ball. Watch what happens. Roddy Marino comes around, sees Rich Rita sitting up there undefensed, and he's within plenty good range to get a good hot shot off. And the hard shot with right-handed is something, again, you don't want to give Rita. Marino sees him. Rita comes in. Really no defenseman on him. He takes one step and just powers a bounce shot. Very tough to read for Ahern in any circumstance. And there you go, 2-1 lead.
Kevin Howes, the younger brother of Tom Howes, a little late applying the defensive pressure there on Rita. And look at Brad Wood again, just take the face off immediately. Boy, he is something else.
You know, the Carolina defense, again, will go from a zone to a man-to-man. They'll shift back and forth. They really try to confuse the offense. Sometimes they get confused, and maybe that was one of those situations.
We've played a minute and a half in the second quarter now. Virginia has taken a 2-1 lead. Marino trying to work on Walker again. He has Nicholas behind the cage. They don't go to the pick play that they used so successfully against Hopkins. And Marino goes up top for Rosebro. Rosebro wants that shot. Fired it wide. Ahern may have got a piece of it. And Walker throws for Ahern. Now Ahern a bad pass. And Virginia will take it back.
Abrams got to tighten his game up a little bit. The great play there was made by Chris Walker. The shot was wide of the net. Chris Walker behind on the soft side of the defense stopped the shot and kept it in play for Abrams.
Well, coming up on ESPN, the French Open, the first Grand Slam event of the year. Will Mats Wilander and Chris Evert Lloyd win it again, or will the tournament favorites and top seeds Martina Navratilova and Ivan Lendl come out on top? We'll check out all the action from Roland Garros Stadium in Paris on ESPN through June the 6th. Right here, it's 2-1. Delaware Stadium in Newark, Delaware, the site of this year's Final Four weekend. Virginia leads 2-1, early action, second quarter. Nicklaus, who's been quiet so far in the game, being watched by House.
And don't forget, Nicklaus scored three goals against Syracuse to get this Virginia team here. Another guy we haven't heard from is number 17. He's on the crease. He's 6'4", Chase Monroe.
Here's Gillen, and he's knocked down. The ball goes loose. Kirk Storch had it, lost it. Nicklaus shoots it and won. Nicklaus had his first good shot at the cage, and you talked about him scoring three against Johns Hopkins. Well, he scored six against North Carolina the first time they played this year, and Virginia beat him.
Look at the hustle here. The ball's on the ground. Good defense by North Carolina. Halls comes in there, but Nicklaus comes in, looks for the opportunity, picks it up, knowing right away the unsettled situation at the goal would be a good chance to get an unsettled Barney Abern. Didn't quite hit the mark.
Well, possession the last 5-6 minutes of this game has belonged exclusively to Virginia, but not right there. Bad play as Gillen dropped the ball. Storch had it. Now Marino with some great hustle will keep the ball for Virginia.
Tommy Engelke over there again, number two. He picks up the ball, might bring it after the midfield to set up an offensive play.
Ball's up top to Gillen. He has one of their two goals. There's Will Rosebrough. He's a junior. Rosebrough has some area behind that net. Goes for Engelke. Back to Rosebrough.
You see the activity on the crease. Every time a guy gets the ball, Engelke up top, there's a lot of activity off the crease. They're cutting in, trying to get open. Even up top, they're trying to give a little activity in the crease. Now they look for a one-on-one situation.
Good shot, and Abern scoops it off the turf. Nice outlet pass. Here comes North Carolina now. Taylor Classic. He's being hounded, and the ball stolen away by Rosebrough. Great ride there by Rosebrough to take it away.
Tremendous ride by Rosebrough.
Nice pass. Gillen had a shot, bobbled it, picks it back up, centers. And just behind Engelke, I believe, or pardon me, Rosebrough, just a little bit behind him, and he couldn't quite handle it. So we've almost played four in this second quarter. Virginia has taken their first lead of the quarter, now one.
When furniture has layers of ugly paint, use Formby's paint remover. But for old varnish, use Formby's furniture refinisher. An independent lab proved my paint remover is more powerful than other well-known brands, yet it won't raise the grain. Formby's furniture refinisher uses my special method to dissolve the ruined finish and reveal the wood's hidden beauty. So for paint, Formby's paint remover. And for varnish, Formby's furniture refinisher. For great results and guaranteed satisfaction, remember, there's only one home of Formby.
Even more than the savings on commissions that we provide investors, we give them a haven where they can conduct their business without all of the hassles and the opinions and pressures from salespeople. We have offices in all the major cities in the United States, some 93. On top of that, we offer a 24-hour, 7-day-a-week service so you can always reach us.
Save on commissions. Call Charles Schwab for this free booklet, 800-255-5000. That's 800-255-5000.
Get on the fast track. When man races to win, you'll finish first on ESPN with innovative coverage of more than 60 races this year. The world's number one motor racing network, ESPN.
Well, we predicted late for the defensive game, but did you think we'd play 19 minutes and have just three goals so far in the game?
Not at all. I think against Syracuse, the Virginia team, if you want to take one team out here and actually examine their performance, against Syracuse, Virginia probably shot 12 times in the first 3 minutes against Syracuse. They came out running and gunning. Here, they're a little more tentative, a little more conservative.
Oh, that's a dangerous pass and a bad one. Howell's made a bad play. Here's Marino. Centers, shot, great save by Abern. as he stonewalled Chase Monroe in front. Here comes Carolina.
Carolina loved the transition play. Look for two passes and a shot.
This is Jim Kester. He goes behind the net, and now Carolina will set things up. They trail 2-1.
Boy, that was a great chance for Virginia to score. They didn't quite get it, and that's how this game can, the game can do to you. Right like that, within 10 seconds, it's down in your defensive half instead of having the one goal.
Pat Welsh, second top point producer behind Seibold, he scores. That did not appear to be that tough of a shot, and I think it really crossed up the goalkeeper down there, Sheehan, as it took a kick off the turf.
Well, he certainly does make a lot of dramatic saves, and this doesn't look like that tough a one to make. Watch. Pat Welsh comes in right-handed. He fakes the look in here. He'll stop his defender and go back for the left-handed. You see Sheehan on the bottom left of your screen. It was not that tough a shot. It might have hit a clump of dirt and bounced with a peculiar motion on it. Watch again as he goes to his left hand. Maybe Sheehan thought he was going high. Nevertheless, a bounce shot, and Welsh will take that goal anytime. They all count the same, 2-2, right between his legs.
And he opened him up wide, and that's the first bad play that he's made in the game, Sheehan. It's now a tie game, 2-2 on the goal by North Carolina.
You know, Doyle Smith, the great statistician, SID down in Virginia, characterized Sheehan by saying he thought he makes a lot of exceptional saves,
yes,
but not always the good ones. And that maybe would fall into the good category.
And we should also point out the area in front of the goal cage already. They played just two games on this field before this game, is considerably warm. This is a football field not used for lacrosse, but they have really cleared out the area already. Good move by Brett Davey. He's coming in. Now we'll circle the net. Fire it, and just behind the cage. Picked up by Crawford, though. He bounces one wide. But Tamillo will win the race there against Todd Breyer, and North Carolina will keep the ball.
That's tremendous offense by North Carolina. You see, they just keep the motion going. One guy gets the ball in a backup situation. He doesn't hesitate. He drives right to the crease again, and then it's backed up another time. They come to the crease again. A good offensive series. Mike Tamillo there on the screen, the winner.
Yes.
Winning shot in overtime against the Hopkins team to put him in this final.
Well, he was perfect. He took one shot, scored one goal.
He saved it for the best time.
But he's never scored a bigger one as they knocked out Hopkins. Here's Kester now. Boy, he's almost railed. Flags fly all over the field as Mike Meyer just almost decapitated him there trying to take that ball away.
Well, we talked about the... Now, Mike Meyer is a short stick. He's the one short stick. You only get to have five of the six sticks long. Watch Meyer. He has a short stick. He's trying to go over the head. You see, he didn't quite make it. Right away, Carolina, maybe Jim Kester stopped his motion to kind of cross up Meyer's motion of going over the head. And the call was a hold. That'll put him in an extra man situation. Now look at this here from another angle. We've got it for you. Again, Meyer not in good position to go over the head. And if you're playing with a short stick, that's something you don't want to do.
Well, this will be North Carolina's third man-up situation. They're 0-2 so far. Nice stick work and a goal. Seibold made a tremendous pass, and Shapinski, the freshman, was there to finish it off.
Well, Shapinski has a lot of savvy, as all these North Carolina players do. He plays the left side on the extra man. He'll park himself on the left, but watch who makes the play again. Gary Seibold looks in. He sees Shapinski open. He's parked on the left-hand crease right there. Shapinski has almost no time to do anything else but redirect the shot and fall into the crease. It was all or nothing, and he got the goal.
Freshman Shapinski now has 16 goals. They've gotten just tremendous production from a trio of freshmen, Shapinski, Tamillo, and Calgano. The three of them have 47 goals now on the year. Shapinski and Calgano have scored one of Carolina's three also on the day, have 16 apiece. And now North Carolina has retaken a 3-2 lead. And now they have a shot for number four, Crawford, and Sheehan made a great save, but Crawford got in tight on a tough angle shot, and then Virginia throws the ball away. Sheehan, in his haste to get that thing out of there, just tossed it away.
Virginia definitely out of sync right now. Sheehan has to go ahead and get a couple saves and settle that defense down. They're not doing the things they normally do down the defensive half of the field that makes their offense click. They're out of sync. They've been rattled by these last two goals. North Carolina, again, just doing what they do all the time. Keep throwing a lot of players at you. Keep moving the ball.
Welsh goes behind the cage for Carolina. Rich Crawford. Crawford scored two against Hopkins on the semifinal win. Seibold back to Welsh. Virginia remains in their man-to-man defense. Kester has a big stick on him, so he gives it up for Rich Crawford. 7:55 to go in this opening half. It is 3-2, North Carolina. Seibold shoots. See, a nice backhand save. Beautiful outlet pass. Boy, right to Breyer. And Breyer dropped the ball. Russell got back on D. Seibold tipped it. Lynn had it. Great take in by Seibold.
That shows you what a hustle will do for you. Todd Breyer had an excellent opportunity for a fast break, but what did he do? He looked behind him because he knew North Carolina was coming after him. And as soon as he looked behind him, he lost concentration, dropped the ball. The ball came back to North Carolina. Their hustle is making the difference so far.
Bobby Russell almost lost it, but gets it back before it reached midfield. He's big hounded. Fires went low. Crawford behind the net. Now he dropped it. Crawford throws far side of the box for Pat Welch there, number 26. Only a sophomore.
Hands up in the air. A sophomore, but he is an All-American. Now here you see Kester, who has the short stick, the one short stick on the field. He tried to go one-on-one against it, was unsuccessful.
Yeah, Meyer nailed him and dropped the ball, but Carolina will come again. Seibold's watched by Lynn. Nice pass in front. Welch couldn't grab it. Now it's loose. And they're killing each other down there. And we have a push called on Virginia. So the ball goes back to North Carolina, 6:41 to play. First half action. Carolina leads this thing 3-2.
Upset of the week is brought to you by Pepto-Bismol. For most common stomach discomforts, the one that coats is the only one you need. The sports tradition of every Memorial Day weekend is the phrase, "Gentlemen, start your engines." But this Memorial Day weekend, those words were never heard at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway because of bad weather. For the first time in the race's history, the 500 had to be postponed for nearly a week because of the rain that wouldn't go away. Weather delays the running of the Indianapolis 500, the Pepto-Bismol upset of the week.
Soon, this place will be jumping. People will stuff themselves with hot dogs and hot tacos, and that can give them heartburn.
Boy, if I were home, I'd take some Pepto.
Oh, you could still take Pepto. Portable Pepto.
When heartburn or upset stomach hits, fight back with Pepto-Bismol. The soothing effectiveness that's in Pepto-Bismol liquid is also in Pepto-Bismol tablets. When you need relief, don't forget portable Pepto tablets. Now, who says you can't take it with you?
Rich Crawford throws the inbound, and North Carolina, who has had the ball a good chunk of the last 5 minutes, Leaf will have it again.
Well, Virginia's definitely playing tight. Carolina just doesn't seem to be fazed by the fact this is a championship game. They don't care about the matchups. They're playing their game. They're moving the ball around, looking for any opportunity to get a good shot. They're very unselfish. Virginia has to sort of let it go, get a little more aggressive on defense.
Rich Crawford, he's being watched there by Chris Walker. Now to Gary Seibold, being watched by Lynn.
Get it behind!
You hear the call of Pete Sheehan in the goal. He's calling out the defense.
Seibold tries to get by Lynn, can't do it. Stumbles. Now fires, and Sheehan made the save. Boy, Seibold one day has to battle DiTommaso. Next day, he's got to battle Lynn. Never lets up.
It's a tough call, but he's up for it. Of course, he set up the winning goal against Johns Hopkins, so he's not fazed by this defense.
Again, Virginia gets a little bit sloppy and throws the ball away, and Carolina grabs it. Rhett Davey, number 43. Our microphone down to the cage area in front of Sheehan, picking up some of the defensive barkings of Sheehan.
And when you keep hearing the pipe sound, that's when he taps his stick against the pipe to make sure he's in the right position. He keeps his eyes on the ball. By tapping the pipe, he knows where his body is.
We have a microphone supported under each goal. We'll also hear Barney Ayburn. Here's Crawford, just wide, as he was being hounded from behind by Chris Walker.
Chris Walker made a nice play, Greg. He was beaten by the player, came in, stayed behind him, and checked the stick to make the play from behind.
Well, the NCAA College World Series Championship is also underway at Rosenblatt Stadium in Omaha. Eight of America's top teams meet to decide the national championship in a double elimination tourney. Who will be some of the big names coming out of this year's tourney? Of course, Pete Incaviglia, star of last year's, now in the big leagues.
Kester again with a short stick on him. Let's see if he goes one-on-one against his short stick, Meyer. Looks like he's setting up for the one-on-one. He's way out in front. Normally that's what a player will do to get a good head of steam. Nope, he dishes off.
North Carolina's outshot Virginia Leaf unofficially 22-13 in this first quarter and a half of action.
Well, 3-2, again, it's almost like a tie game. Yesterday, Carolina stayed within two goals of Hopkins, and that's not enough to get a good lead against any team in lacrosse.
Be careful, the Welsh. He can do it. That is his forte right there. So spin off the man, and seems like he has no shot, but he gets an awfully good one off.
Well, he's done it for two games in a row. We saw him in the semifinals do it against a great Johns Hopkins team. Here he is now matching up against Bob Schutler of Virginia. He overplays to the right, the defense does, and see the double coming in. And Welsh has a great sense about that. He feels the overplay on his right-hand side. He can shoot equally well right or left. So watch. He'll wait for the overplay to his right. He's shooting left-handed, but his right-hand side. Now he goes back to the right hand and goes ahead and rips one in low. Very tough against this uneven surface to gauge that low shot. We've seen Sheehan not handle the low shots. Welsh knows that. He's keeping it low, and he's been successful.
That's a name to watch. Pat Welsh. He has two goals on the day. A sophomore, last year All-American. All-American as a freshman. And Carolina now has scored three straight goals, and they go on top 4-2 with 4:08 to play in the opening half.
Game is flying by again. The ball does not leave the surface. It's a very thick carpet here at Delaware. It's a gorgeous surface, but the ball rolls very slowly, and for that reason, the clock moves very quickly, and with only 3 minutes left, this half is almost gone.
It's a little faster track than the semifinals. They have cut this lawn since play 2 days ago. Nice play there by Walker as he took it away, and he comes across midfield.
You heard the checks of the sticks when it hit Roddy going behind. He should have passed off, maybe. He's looking to do it all himself at this point.
Chris Calgado, freshman attack man out of Green Neck, New York. As we told you before, a lot of these Tar Heels and Cavaliers are from the New York area and Long Island.
Billy Scroggs is an excellent young team. He just keeps throwing these young guys at you. He'll substitute two, three, four freshmen on attacking in the midfield that are all excellent ball handlers. So he keeps his team fresh for 60 minutes.
3:13 to play in the half. Here comes Tamillo. Roseboro makes a nice stick check, and Sheehan's all over it. That's great Virginia defense right there. Now Sheehan takes a body, remains composed, and finds Lynn. There's a dangerous pass. Engelke gets labeled by Brown.
What a play by Engelke, though. He got it off the Roseboro, who couldn't handle it. Could have been a great play.
Now Walker kind of shuffles the ball. Engelke races it down. And I believe he stepped out of bounds at the far sideline there.
That's exactly the call, Greg. Engelke, excellent hustle, got the loose ball, fired back into Sheehan, but a little too close, dancing on that white chalk.
Well, let me ask you, Leif, obviously this is a critical game, but we'll talk about it when we come back in a moment here. Some of the sights and sounds from Newark, Delaware. Carolina scored three straight goals.
The athlete's foot can fit you with a shoe that fits the way you run. Like the Pegasus GX, the most popular Nike running shoe ever. Or the Venue, one of Nike's most technically advanced models. And now, we offer the Windrunner, new from Nike, but already developing a loyal following. Join the Nike Spring Trials at the athlete's foot and get fit right, because nobody knows the athlete's foot like the athlete's foot.
Who says you can't have 100% imported hops and a less filling beer? Old World Aging and a less filling beer. Smooth, super premium taste and a less filling beer. Michelob Light, the best of both worlds.
Michelob Light, oh yes you can. Have it all.
Tar Heels, 4 in Virginia, 2. And I wanted to talk to you, Leif, about appears Virginia is just tight. And they have not played well. Carolina hasn't played all that much better, but they are up by 2 goals, and we've seen a lot of sloppy play early in the game.
No question about it. Ace Adams right there trying to get his troops to relax a little bit. I talked about how their intensity starts from the defense. They haven't played their game yet. They've had more shots against Syracuse in the first 2 minutes. Engelke's one guy that's trying to get the team going, and we might take a look at the play he made a minute ago. Watch this. Engelke goes up, knocks the ball down. He's hammered. It was an alley-oop pass by the goalie. Not too well advised, but Engelke maintains composure. Look at that. Flat on his back, rolls the ball out to Roseboro, who maybe didn't expect it, but didn't pick it up cleanly. Good hustle by Engelke. But this Virginia team will follow the lead of their defense. They are defensively led, and that team has to start picking up the ball, start cleaner checks, and start running hard. They ran extremely hard against Syracuse and pushed it right up the field.
How in the world did Engelke hold on to that ball? I mean, Brown just labeled him, and he was able to keep it at his stick.
Shows a great skill of these midfielders today in the game of lacrosse. All of them can do that, and that's why they're dangerous and high scorers from the midfield.
That's a dying art. We're going to talk about that at halftime. Leafs going to have a little feature on the so-called demise of the midfielder in lacrosse. That'll be coming up at half. Still about 2:14 of action left, though, until we reach half. Nice save by Sheehan as Kester bounced one high as it kicked up off the turf.
Now they're running like they did against Syracuse, Greg. This is how they pushed it.
That's Beeger. He's known for this. That's his 10th goal of the year. John Beeger is known as a tremendous player in transition. Leaf with the big stick, and what do you say? He did it here.
We'll talk about it at halftime, Hal. Look at this. A long six midfielder. Not only do they play defense, but they can come down and shoot if you give them a chance. He made a beautiful face dodge. He had little or no angle with the right-hand shot, but that didn't stop. Look at no angle here. He leaps up to get a better angle over the top of the head of Barney Abram. Barney Abram came out high. A great shot by Beeger. That was the inspiration we talked about. The catalyst of the Virginia team is in the defense, and that's the kind of thing that can spark the team.
Now, we're told that it's not a record. Beeger's 10th goal this year for a defenseman is not a record, but certainly a tremendous amount. 4-3 now. Carolina trying to get one back. Brown shoots. Sheehan comes up big again. Loose ball picked up by Virginia, dropped by Virginia, and the ball goes back to Carolina.
Virginia definitely would like to shut down North Carolina here. They stopped the momentum of North Carolina with that great shot by Beeger. They'd like to get the ball back, maybe get one more shot. If somebody, either North Carolina or Virginia can get a goal with only a minute and 40 left in this half, that would be a big momentum builder for the second half.
That's Rich Crawford going to put it in play for head coach Willie Scroggs. His North Carolina Tar Heels being watched by Chris Walker. And Walker strips it, and now it's loose. The race is on. Schupler trying to pick it up there, but Welsh throws a body at him.
But Greg, did you notice how much more aggressive Walker was in that defensive series? It's like Beeger sort of sparked the defense. The defense is now playing a little looser. I think they're playing a little more aggressively. We'll see what the call is on the far sideline. We've got a slash call, good for 1 minute. Unfortunately, that aggression turned into a penalty. And now Virginia will be a man down, if it appears from here. We're way up here on top of the far side, so I think that was going to be unnecessary roughness. This is the call by the PA announcer. And North Carolina is going to have a very fortuitous man advantage with a minute and a half left.
Call's going to be on Mike Meyer, the junior midfielder. He'll be off for 1 minute.
And Mike Meyer has been a little bit too aggressive in his first half. He had the one over the head. He's been the culprit for the last two penalties, actually.
Well, Ace Adams has got to watch his team go on a man down situation for a fourth time now. Carolina's won out of the first three opportunities. They scored the last one. Great pass by Seibold. Chapinski cashed in.
North Carolina is known as a backdoor team. They like to feed the back door, so watch for that again. Seibold loves to go to the backside, soft side, to get a good shot on an assist.
Bobby Russell winds it up. It's 5-3 North Carolina.
That was very strange because John Beeger was above Robbie Russell, and usually when you're man down, you don't play above or outside the circle of offense. You normally stay in tight. I didn't quite understand it. Right now, they're watch this. As they come inside, now watch Beeger, number 12. He'll slide out almost too high. Actually, he wasn't a culprit at all. He was in great position. I might say 21, Scott Lynn. It's hard to say a guy was a culprit. Let's give credit to Robbie Russell. It was a great shot, but the point being that Robbie Russell was too close to a man-up situation. You don't let a guy get that close, stand there, and just go ahead and shoot it.
Well, Robbie Russell fired 9 shots in the semifinal win against Hopkins, didn't get a goal. And he gets one right there. And it appears that Carolina wants to bounce the balls on Sheehan. He appears to be much stronger on the straight-on shots, having trouble with some of the ground balls.
Absolutely. I think the coaching staff has definitely told North Carolina, go to the ground ball, go to the bounce shot. He's not reading it as well. He stands so comfortable, so relaxed in the high shots, they feel if they bounce it, he cannot read the uncertainty of the surface.
Virginia's home field back in Charlottesville. Scott Stadium is AstroTurf also. Shot never got through by Brett Davey, and Virginia down by 2.
Here's Beeger again.
He's something to watch. Long stick. Beeger. Nice pass. Goal.
Beautiful play. There it is. Beeger setting up the tempo of the offense for Virginia. They've done it all year long. Beeger responsible for the last 2 goals. He scored one himself. This time he had to be respected. He came flying down the side. The defense slid to him. Now watch this. The defense fighting to get back in front of Beeger. He senses that, so he goes to Marino this time. See the defense waiting for him this time? Marino all by himself. Cranks it low. Barney Abram again. Very tough one to stop. But Beeger, give him all the credit in the world. He's forcing the tempo of the game. Here it is again, coming down right hand. He feels the defense slide to him. See that? 3 Carolina players. So he senses the pressure. Feeds off to Roddy Marino all by himself. A good bounce shot. The defense was too late. No time for Auburn, and there's a timeout now with 17 seconds left to go. A great goal to bring it back to 5-4.
And that's Ronnie Marino's first goal of the year, his 33rd of the year, and it makes it a 5-4 game. While we have a moment, let's remind our ESPN viewers that coming up Monday, June the 2nd at 2 p.m. Eastern Time, we'll begin our coverage of the World Cup Soccer. It'll be the Soviet Union against Hungary in the first game. Teams from 24 nations will travel to Mexico this year to vie for international supremacy in soccer's ultimate spectacle. ESPN will televise games from the first round, three games from the second round, the semifinals, and third place games. As far as international excitement, there's nothing quite like the World Cup Soccer Showdown. As we get a look at Ace Adams and the Virginia Cavaliers, who haven't won a national championship game since 1972 in the sport of lacrosse. And there is some talk back in Charlottesville about their not being able to handle the pressure situations well, not doing well in tournament time. Obviously, this tournament, they've done well to get here, but they haven't won the big one in a long time.
They've got loose enough to go ahead and let it all hang out. They did it against Syracuse and were very successful. They can play the game of lacrosse. It's a fluid game. It's a team game. It's a 10-man game. And Bezier has shown that by taking the ball from one end of the field to the next and making the transition happen, letting the good stick work of this Virginia team show itself. It's 5-4. It's anybody's ball game, and we got a lot of lacrosse left in the second half.
Well, we don't have much left in this first half, though. We have just 17 seconds to go. Critical faceoff. It'll be Brown against Woods, the specialty for each team. Woods the better one, and he gets it again. Look at him break in. He picks it up again and gets a shot away. Auburn throws it away. Now Brett Davey. They have 4 seconds. 2 seconds. Long shot. Never got through. Lynn blocked it. And that is the first half of play. 5-4. At the end of the first two quarters, it is a lead of one for North Carolina. Stay tuned. Leif Elsmo, former player, former midfielder from Bowling Green, will talk about the demise, as he puts it, of the midfielder coming up at halftime. Stay tuned.
I love watching old Florida State football films. I get such a kick out of watching this stuff. Hey, that's me, number 46. Look at that kid go. Almost got me there. What moves? What a running back. And now here comes my greatest moment of glory. Some things are too good to last. My longest yards against Auburn University. You know, I was always trying to be a hit back then. On the football field, off the football field, wherever. Maybe you're trying to be a hit now, too. There's no easy way. You got to work for it. I'll tell you one thing. Drugs is not the answer. Not then, not now. I've seen it all too often in this business, in sports, with teenagers. Nobody ends up a winner with drugs. It takes guts to be a winner. When you reach your goal, it's great to know that you did it on your own. After all, you can't be a hit when you're high.
Something to think about from the NCAA.
I'd like to take a few moments to explain to you the importance of a long stick in today's game of lacrosse. You're seeing a lot of it in today's championship play. You see a lot of it all the way through Division I play, and the reasons are varied. If you go back to the genesis of the actual plastic head in the 70s, the attackmen started playing with a molded head, and the attack was still the focal point of the scoring of the lacrosse team. Doug Ward, a local product here, is going to help me illustrate this. If Doug was a midfielder, he would come down the field, give it to me, the attackman, and he would help me work the offense. But still, the attack was the focal point of scoring. Now, with these plastic heads in the 70s, Doug, as a midfielder, got to be much more proficient with shooting. His stick handling got better, and he got more of a hard shot, a more accurate shot, and he became a more integral part of the offense. So scores started to go from 8 goals a game, 9-10, almost doubled. His average score is about 16 goals a game, primarily because Doug, as a midfielder now, was very proficient at scoring. And he had an advantage. The advantage was he was not playing against a long sticks defenseman like an attackman would be. He was playing against a short stick midfielder like I would be. That puts me at a disadvantage. Why? Because there's not much space between us. If I was a defenseman, I'd have a longer stick, I'd have more distance between us, and I could play Doug more easily, keep distance between us, give him poke checks without getting too close for his quickness and speed. But he was a good offensive player now as a middie, and I was playing with a short stick, and he was taking advantage of that. Scores were doubling. Coaches had to do something, and they did. They said, these midfielders are looking too much like attackmen. We're going to make our midfield defense look more like defensemen. They gave their midfield defense long sticks. And that's what happened. They had long sticks units. That was their specialty. As soon as the ball came down into the defensive half of the field and the whistle would blow, they'd make a switch. The long sticks midfielder would come into play. And if Doug was a middie, I could now play him much better. I could keep the distance. And I got the scores back down to a reasonable number and kept them in the game, the long sticks midfielder. That was the second generation defenseman. Now we're into a third generation, and today's game is a great illustration of that. A guy like John Bezier for UVA, he scored 9 goals with a long stick. Why? Because after a number of years of playing defense with this stick, he also had to clear the ball. And they got tremendously proficient at handling the ball with the long stick. You'll see him, as we see him today, he takes up off the field and goes up into the offensive half, and instead of coming off the field for an attack player or an attack middie, he'll keep going. He'll come in with great stick work, great mobility, and come in and get a good shot off in the offensive half of the field. That's the third generation defenseman. Very good at using a long stick. But what it's done is that it's changed the game. They've redefined the positions, not wanting to do that. The midfielder isn't even in evidence anymore. What you have is basically 6 attackmen and 6 defensemen. The ball goes across midfield, and then they switch again. There's 6 attackmen and 6 defensemen. The backbone of lacrosse was always the middie, and he isn't even here anymore. So to get the middie back, the rules committee hopes to, in 1987, eliminate most of the long sticks, except on the defense. They hope to limit the number of long sticks to 4, meaning you can only have 1 long stick in the midfield unit. Thereby, we'll be going back to the short stick, reintroducing the midfielder and the backbone of the game of lacrosse. We'll be back with more great action in today's championship game after this break.
PGA Tour Commissioner Dean Beaman created the Stadium Golf Course.
How could we have all been so dumb for so long in thinking that we could continue to attract literally tens of thousands of fans out here when they couldn't see you play golf?
It's a new and better way to watch the pros at play. It's also a money machine. I'm Warren Corbett. Nation's Business Today looks at the profitable partnership between the golf pros and the real estate pros. Monday, here on ESPN.
Energizer Halogen. A light so bright, so white, no ordinary light can match it. The Energizer Halogen flashlight. Up to 300% more light than ordinary flashlights. And it's Energizer rugged, even waterproof. The Energizer Halogen flashlight. So bright, so incredibly bright, it outshines ordinary flashlights. Up to 300% brighter from Energizer.
North Carolina holding on to a 1-goal lead at the end of the first 30 minutes of action. Greg Papa welcoming you back to Newark, Delaware, in Delaware Stadium. And no, I'm not working with the amazing Kreskin, but rather Leif Elsmo. But Leif, you hit it right on the head in your piece at halftime, the development of the big stick, and Bezier is the best around.
Well, we talked about how these guys can, the third-generation defenseman not only plays great midfield defense, but now he goes on clears, and he's an offensive weapon. Look at Bezier here. Throws away the defenseman coming down, leaps up, and has tremendous accuracy with that long stick, beating Barney Abram. That was a goal that turned away the momentum of North Carolina. Now, the next time down, this is 2 of the last 3 scores, mind you. Here's Bezier pumping up that Virginia offense by coming down again on a fast break. He knows he's being triple-teamed, as you see the blue shirts come into evidence. He feeds off to Roddy Marino, the great attackman, who bounces in a shot. Give Bezier 1 goal, 1 assist, and by the way, that makes him the leading offensive weapon for Virginia in the first half.
He really pumped him up late as we get a glance at some of the numbers in the game. The shots, the big total right there, 25 for Carolina, but 14 of them did hit the net, so only 11 saves. A lot of saves for Sheehan, and he came up with some big ones.
Well, the good news for North Carolina is that they have a 5-4 lead at halftime. The bad news for North Carolina is that Virginia was down by 1 against Navy and beat them.
Yes.
Virginia was down by 1 against Syracuse and beat them, and they're down by 1 against North Carolina. So if that means anything, I can definitely tell you that UVA is a second-half team. But, of course, North Carolina had to come from behind also against the great Hopkins team. So we look for a real good second half here. Hopefully Virginia will get the cobwebs out and run a little bit more.
Ace Adams trying to get his 9th ring. 4 as a player, 4 as a coach. But no rings as a head coach here at Virginia now in his 9th year. He's taken the Wahoos to 9 straight NCAA appearances. Willie Scroggs. And he's a perfect 2-for-2 in the championship round.
As we look at the face-off, Greg, face-offs in the first half pretty even. Virginia winning 6 of 11, So not much advantage for either team. The great Brad Wood not having it his way, but he got his way this time.
And he got one right there. They've now got 7 out of 12. And the ball slips back into the defensive end for Virginia. Lind. Scott Lind shuttles it underneath. And taken there by Chris Walker, throws back there his net, and Sheehan. That's Peter Sheehan, a junior goaltender. Lind goes down low to scoop it up. Let's see if they clear this one out. Nice Lind. Pass by Lind. Good timing.
Very well timed. Waited for the pressure and just got off the last moment.
This is John Gillett, number 32. He has one of Virginia's 4 goals. We are just underway. Third quarter action. The winner is the NCAA Lacrosse Division I champion for 1986.
All the marbles right here. 5-4 game. It's anybody's game. You'll see both teams win it all out right here.
Nicklaus back to Gillen. We played almost a minute here in the third quarter. Here's Engelke. Former Johns Hopkins Blue Jay player. Nice pass. Rosebro. Shot. Fired wide.
Boy, that was a great shot with a short stick. Rosebro did not have much chance to go back and get much backlash with his stick. He choked up on it and got a real hard shot high against Avery.
Well, these Frogs fill us in a couple of defensive people to come into the game as we get a look at Barney Avern. He had some big shoes to fill during the offseason with the graduation of Tim Neely. And Avern certainly has responded for North Carolina this year. He's only a sophomore, so he'll be around for a while.
See Avern moving around before the ball is brought into play. This is the beginning of the second half, so he wants to get a little bit of sweat going.
Roddy Marino against Walker, and he beat him. Got a good shot off, but he could not beat Avern. Tom Howes now plays catch with his goaltender. And now Kurt Storch has some open field.
The defenders use the goalie to set up the clear. The goalie is the one man not covered in the riding situation. And the goalie comes out of the crease area. You've got 4 players against 3.
And Avern was able to just roll him out of his crease the first half. They successfully cleared their first 6 and wound up 8 of 11.
Absolutely. Look, they're doing it again. Watch. They're letting Avern walk uncontested to the midfield stripe. This is weird only by the fact that Virginia should shut off everybody else. If they shut off everybody else, they'll make him get in a bad situation. They don't really play that tough. There was a good check.
Well, he just nailed Tomillo. Great check there by Breyer. And now the race is on. Breyer, big stick, takes the ball away. Here come Virginia. This is Nicklaus. And he scores. What a shot.
Fantastic shot by Nicklaus. And that was set up by that ride, the ride that did not work in the first half. They let Avern come up to the midfield stripe. They say, go ahead. They shut off everybody else close. They check the ball away by playing tough. And look at Avern. He is mad that one came in. Nicklaus coming down with a left-handed shot. He'd rather go right. The defense slides over. Look at that beautiful left-handed shot right up in the corner. Couldn't have been more accurate. Again, Nicklaus looking to the right, seeing he had nobody to pass to. Avern giving him the far side. He took the far side. And boom, tie game.
He let it go at the precise moment he had to before the defense collapsed on him and the angle changed on him. Jeff Nicklaus, that's his first goal of the game. He had 3 against Johns Hopkins, and now for the third time in this game, we're tied 5-5. It was 4-2 at one stage, Carolina late in the second quarter, but now we're dead even.
Virginia looks like a little bit different team in the second half. They're running harder, they're collapsing on the ball.
Walker throws it away. Here's Chase Monroe. He's a starting attack man for Virginia. He can play a whole lot.
He plays the crease, and he is a heck of a target because he's 6'3", Greg. We haven't seen him today because they don't feed the crease that much. Virginia goes to more of a power offense, but he, at that height, is a tremendous target on the crease.
Now Virginia will attack him again here. Mark Altimus or Nicklaus.
We can watch that clear again later on, Greg. It was totally ineffective in the first half, but that time it worked to perfection. They didn't change it at all, which was interesting. They just did it right. They did it correctly all the way down the line.
There's Altimus again. Big shot. Got through, but Avern was able to steer it wide. It rolls near sideline, out of bounds. And the ball will go over to North Carolina.
On that play, I could notice what Chris Monroe's chief job was there. He was screening Avern. At his size, 6'3", he's covering a lot of territory. He tried to screen the shot for Avern, so that he couldn't see where it was coming from. Avern didn't let that happen, though. He got down on his knees, saw the shot coming, made a great save.
And it appears after moments of playing tight, both clubs in the first half, Leaf, the teams have loosened up a little bit, and the style of lacrosse, the brand of lacrosse, is much better here in the early action of the second half.
It is, and again, it comes from, in Virginia's side at least, it comes from that defense. When they start running like Beezer did at the end of the first half, the rest of the team sort of loosens up. They're aggressive, starting from the defense. North Carolina, opportunistic, and they've been that in the first half.
Well, these two teams have worked a long time to get in this situation, a shot to win the title. They've both overcome considerable adversity.
Look at them leave Ahburn open in the middle. Again, that time it didn't work because North Carolina was very, very patient. But they're leaving Ahburn open to go ahead and take the clear. They feel like he doesn't handle the ball that well, obviously.
Behind the Cavalier net, Rich Crawford throws for Seibold. Off far side of the box, it's Pat Welsh. He's being watched there by Schupler.
Now, Welsh is very dangerous out in front. Interesting that they would put him behind. He scored all his goals out front. Here they are inverting him.
Carolina trying to retake their lead. Brett Davey has a step on a man, shoots. Sheehan got a piece of it to steer it wide. The ball rolls out of bounds. That was a shot. And Carolina was closest to it when the ball rolled out, so they will keep the ball. There's a good look at Peter Sheehan, the only member of the Final Four goaling starters that came into this weekend that played last year. As a sophomore and a junior, he'll be back again in the Nets next year for the Cavaliers as a senior.
When you hear somebody yelling, you hear that pipe, that's Sheehan calling out the defensive assignments. Listen to him talk.
Shot went a little high, scooped up there by the long stick of Chris Walker. Rich Crawford bodies him. Loose ball. That's a big one, too. Tomillo almost grabbed it, but he was being bumped by Lynn. And Carolina cannot quite grab it. Now they do. Pat Welsh, good pass. Seibold has shot at the side of the back away.
Excellent series there by both teams. They're both doing what they want to do. The defense for Virginia being aggressive, and North Carolina, that is, waiting for that opportunistic moment.
Dead even at five. Nice pass. Oh! Kester simply dropped it there. He had a golden opportunity. Here comes Virginia now. Big rush by Gillard. Marino. Shot and a goal.
That was great stick work. An absolute textbook fast break.
Chase Monroe, the goal scorer.
First goal for Chase Monroe, but let me tell you what, you couldn't draw it any better, Greg, if you drew out the extra man play on a chalkboard. This is textbook. The play coming straight down the middle. You see Virginia bringing it down. Mike Meyer, who had made a couple mistakes in the first half, redeeming himself. He looks, surveys the defense, goes to the point man out to the right. They've set up a box now. The defense is three people trying to play four in the box. Goes down to the point for the right-handed shot. The defense, if this is executed correctly, the defense has little or no chance. He looks to his right, feeds to the point man. They are in a box. He goes down to the lower box. And just like that, Chase Monroe takes one step, bounces it past the tough save by Ahburn. Anyway, great fast break, 6-5 Virginia.
That assist for Roddy Marino now gives him 3 points on the game, and it gives Virginia the lead back for them at 6-5. And take a break here, 9:24 to play. Third quarter, Cavaliers now have gone on top by one.
Well, somebody's happy to be going to work.
I love my job.
I wish I could say that.
Bob.
I know. Look for a better job in the National Business Employment Weekly.
See? The best jobs available everywhere in the country. Professional, managerial, technical, that's you, at top companies.
Nice salaries.
$25,000 a year and up. There are articles to help you land a better job, how to look good in interviews, write a better resume, and the reason I still read it, articles to help you do better on the job. How to handle office politics, when to ask for a raise, how to deal with an impossible boss.
Okay, I'm convinced. I'm a National Business Employment Weekly reader.
Don't make a career move without it.
Ask for the National Business Employment Weekly at your newsstand, or if you prefer, get the next 8 issues by first-class mail for $35. Call toll-free 800-372-3000. 8 weekly issues, $35. Call 800-372-3000 now.
900-976-1313. ESPN Dial Sports. The number for the latest scores, stats, and trends. Plus ESPN programming information. For just 50 cents a call, you get the country's best scoreboard service. Plus our primetime lineup. 900-976-1313. ESPN Dial Sports. Call anytime.
Alongside Leif Elsmo, Brett Papa. We are back in Delaware. Third quarter, Seibold trying to tie it up, and he does. How'd that get through? Near side of the cage, he beats Sheehan. Seibold off balance, Leif, with a very tough shot. Goldie just kind of squeaked in.
Well, I tell you, that was a great play by Gary Seibold. He's not going to beat you that much one-on-one, but he beats you right here. Watch this, tremendous play. I think when he was hit in the face, Sheehan might have relaxed just a moment because that might have been called a slash. It wasn't called. The referee let him play on. Watch again. 5'7", 155 pounds. He goes right through that hard check. He doesn't stop for a moment. A good bounce shot past Sheehan. You cannot relax for a minute in the goal. The shots are all accurate. They're all hard. A very tough position to play in the game of lacrosse in 86, and Sheehan has his work cut out for him.
Well, Seifel's something else. He's not fast. He's not strong. He's quick, and he's good. He picks up all the loose balls and makes a lot of things happen. Ties the game right there, 6-6. First goal of the game for Seifel.
And the fourth tie of the game, Seifel, tremendous, again, at picking the right shot at the right moment.
Well, we now have our fourth tie of this NCAA title game. This first ever All-ACC final. In fact, the first ever time that two clubs from the same conference got out of the final two. And the first time in 10 years, one of the two, not Johns Hopkins.
A good shot here as you see the crease and you'll see the activity off the ball. If they do it, they'll be cutting against the grain.
Shot from the outside by Ultimus was smothered, never got through to Ayburn. Scramble is on, picked up by Brett Davies. Trying to give the Tar Heels a lead here, but he's smothered from behind. Great defensive hustle there by Rich Rita. And now he's hammered by Crawford. Let a lot of things go there. Nice pass by Rita. What a great play.
It's going to be a fast break the other way. Look at this. Here comes somebody from the sideline.
This is David Smith to Roddy Marino. The big shot, and Ayburn's there. Fired it right at him.
I tell you, if Ayburn had to move at all, that would have been a tough save. Unfortunately, Roddy Marino didn't go high enough with it or low enough with it. It went right in his stick.
It's been generally a slowdown game with moments where the tempo has really reached a fever pitch, and last minute or so there, Leifert got hot.
Well, both teams will take that opportunity to get them a chance to run a fast break. Everybody wants a 4-on-3, and that's what's happened the last few months.
North Carolina, who led 5-4 at half, now are tied 6-6, trying to go ahead, and they do. That's Robbie Russell. That's his second goal of the game. And North Carolina has retaken the lead now, 7-6 with 7:24 to play in the third quarter.
Robbie Russell, the 6'1 senior out of Baltimore, he takes this opportunity to get a step on his defender, comes with a hard bounce shot. That's the kind of shot that Sheehan, again, 9 times out of 10, he'll make a save there. Not that it wasn't a good shot by Russell, but it was time. He had good time to see it all the way through. It wasn't a great save. Here we go again. Russell, he's well in front of the goal. Sheehan, again, most times would save that, but Russell had a great shot that went just 2 inches inside the pipe, again, making it tough for Sheehan to stop.
Now big ground ball taken away by Virginia momentarily, but Breyer got dumped. And the ball now picked up by Brett Davey of North Carolina. Davey gets smothered. Boy, they hammered him. Great check there by Brad Wood. Flags all over the field. Virginia's bench is going wild down there. We got a hold called here.
Technical foul, hold.
Should mention the referee today is Walt Munsey.
Looks like it'll be extra man for North Carolina again. I don't think North Carolina has a penalty all day, if I'm not mistaken.
No, they don't.
Virginia has not been extra, and this is the fourth situation where they have a man advantage, or the fifth, actually, a man advantage over Virginia. That can absolutely kill a team. Think about that. 5 times they've had an advantage over North Carolina or over Virginia.
Look at this action here,
Lee.
Look
at that play. Is that Meyer again?
There goes Rosebro.
Rosebro.
Rosebro was called for the hold.
Wrapping around with one hand on the stick. Again, when you do that with one hand on the stick, the referee already has a hand on his flag. You can very rarely make a clean check in that situation.
Man up situation, Carolina. They're fifth. They've scored 1 of the 4. Russell, he has a big shot, and it kicks out of the cage there and caroms out of bounds. The ball will remain in the custody of the North Carolina Tar Heels, though. That was a shot.
I can't believe this, but the penalty's up. That was a fast 30 seconds. It's all even.
All right, they're now 1 for 5 on man-up situations.
2 for 5.
Well, that'll up the ante a little bit, from 20% to 40%. This is Jim Kester, number 10 for North Carolina. Another whistle.
Warding off is the call. You might have seen Kester's hand. He had a good, tough defense played by Meyer, and Kester was trying to sort of push off. Watch Kester's offhand. Watch his left hand. He'll come in here with a good defense by Meyer. Now it's his right hand that he pushes off with. He sort of shoos away the stick of Meyer. He can't do that. That's called warding off. Penalty. The ball goes over to Virginia.
Right now, the ball's in the stick of that man, Will Rosebro. He takes a slap from Seifel.
parabolic mic heard the impact of that. You can see the checking is pretty intense down close.
This game has lived up to its advanced billing of being a war. Physically, they've been killing each other. Now John Gillen for Nicklaus. He gets smothered by two Tar Heels as Tom Howes was there, and also to stop him with some good defense with Scott Price. They're keeping a close eye on Roddy Marino, top goal scorer, number six for Virginia. He does have 3 points on the game, though, one goal and a couple of assists. 5:40 to play in this third quarter. Shot goes through. It's stopped nicely by Aburn. Carolina leads this one 7-6. Here's Rosebro now, dropping it back to Engelke.
Engelke trying to set up for the right-hand shot again.
Good first step. Got a good shot off. Aburn stopped it, but we have a foul coming up there. It's going to be a slash.
It's a slash right in the head.
So it'll be a man-up situation coming up for Virginia. We come back to Newark, Delaware. Wahoos will try and tie it up.
Who says you can't have it all? Who says you can't love your work and the change of pace? Who says you can't have light beer with super premium taste? Michelob Light.
Oh, yes, you can.
Michelob Light.
Oh, yes, you can.
Super premium taste. And a less filling beer.
Michelob Light, oh yes you can.
As we return to action, we see Engelke coming in. Watch the slash in the head by Carolina. Right there in McCambridge, hits him in the head. Contact was sometimes going to be a brush off, but that was a little too intense. That was a slashing call. Good for a minute in the penalty box. Virginia's first chance at an extra man goal.
All right, and if they get it, they'll tie the game. We have 5:05 to play in this third quarter. Trying to find a crack in this defense of North Carolina. Roddy Marino behind the cane for Engelke. Back to Marino. That's Rich Rita. Ultimus back to Rita. Had an opening pass inside. Was deflected and stolen. Kirk Storch, and he almost, very dangerous pass. As it almost went to the cage there, but Aburn was there to stop it. Also, a Cavalier was right there. Now the clear, nice pass. That was a beauty by Tom House. As he hit him on the fly, Tyler Classen made the catch. And now they release the penalty as Brown got across into the box. So they're even up again.
Virginia's confused right now. They've got a man advantage on Carolina.
Great stick work behind the cage for Calgano. He spins, shoots, fires wide, and it'll go out of bounds near the sideline, and North Carolina will keep the ball on the attempted shot there.
Delgado had a nice shot, but what he did, he took himself out of any possibility of scoring by rolling to his left hand. He was on the right plane of the goal. If he would have come right-handed, he had a chance to make a goal with little or no angle. But when he went back to his left hand, he was shooting with the plane of the goal and took himself out of contention for a shot.
Pat Welch, number 26, behind the net for North Carolina. He spins to his left, now right side of the cage.
Right-handed shot coming up.
He got knocked down, ball stolen away, but a whistle.
And warding off.
Schupler, that was all over him.
Great, the call is warding off again. Pat Welch was setting himself up for his right-handed shot. We've seen him do it so successfully the last few days. Here, we'll look at it again. Watch, he's setting himself up. He wants the defenseman to overplay him, but watch him push back with his right hand. Actually, you didn't see. There it is, right there. On the loose ball situation, what it was a good check. The ball was on the ground, then Welch tried to ward away the defenseman with his off hand. You can't take the hand off the stick and play the man. You have to keep it on the stick where it becomes part of that actual stick.
Bob Schupler over to the bench now, gets a blow, the sophomore. And Jim Ace Adams shuffles up his people as they now try to clear it out of their own zone. They're going to drop it back and come again, though. Sheehan, nice pass, hits Rita. Rita being watched there by Scott Price. He's a freshman, Scott Price. Number 25 for North Carolina. Ultimus throws right side of the offensive box to Nicklaus.
They call out a play, Greg. They call out special. So they're running their special play here on offense.
Yeah, we'll see how special it turns out to be. Jeff Nicklaus, they've held him in check pretty much today. They've had a good man out on Houses on him right now, number 13.
Right in the face, that'll be a slash. Oh, they didn't call it.
No flag down, didn't catch that one.
The crowd wanted it, they heard it up there in the stands, but they did not call it.
Rich Rita now, good burst of speed, but he forgot the ball. One minor detail. Here comes North Carolina, Scott Price. Dropping it back to Howes. He's got some good legs. Look at him motor.
Tell you, Howes was the best defenseman in the country 2 years ago. Did not play last year. Back this year, looking for a dream year going to the national championship.
Number nine behind the cage, Calgano. We have 2.5 to play in this third quarter. Looks like we're going right down to the wire this year to decide the new champion. Brett Davey, number 43, just outside of the box. Midfielder eyes the defense, surveys it, now spins on it. Ultimus on him, and the shot went high, but Sheehan caught it anyway. Now a nice outlet pass, a beautiful pass to Ultimus. Nice pass. Oh, just tipped from behind as he was trying to nail Ed Harney down there, and a good recovery by Carolina's defense to prevent a good shot on net.
Well, Ultimus threw it a little bit early. What you do in a fast break situation is you penetrate until somebody picks you up. He threw it from way far outside the box. He has to penetrate until where he is an offensive threat and the defense slides on him. If nobody slides on you, you take a shot. Ultimus was a little bit eager to get his feet off, and the defense had a chance to knock it down.
The ball was tipped by North Carolina, so Virginia will retain possession here as we are now under 2 minutes to play in the third quarter. Marino had an angle, but Walker was on his back, so he decided to come again. Left side. Kind of shoveled it there, and he flung it over the top of that out of bounds. It'll remain North Virginia ball.
Here's a play on Nicholas that was not called, I believe. And watch it in the face. See up there around the face? Yeah. Referees have a half a second to make up their mind whether that's going to be one to decide the fate of the game or not. In that particular situation, they called it a brush off. It didn't affect the play, so they didn't call it.
Here's Roseboro now. Gets in, shoot, scores, flag went down. The goal will count. Roseboro, despite the infraction of North Carolina, gets a goal to tie this game up at 7-7.
Roseboro's first, second point of the game, and or second goal. Here he comes around. He got slashed in the head. The penalty, the flag was in. There it is. There's a slash. The play continues in lacrosse. He got slashed in the head. Watch this. Roseboro gets a good jump on his defender. The slash comes to the head. He doesn't stop at all. He comes in with a good bounce shot against Barney Ayburn, and the bounce shot seems to be the one that's been successful today. The ground being a little bit tough to predict, and the bounce shot found its mark there for a 7-7 tie.
Good look at Will Roseboro there, Leaf. Voted last year the most improved player on the Cavalier Club. He has rallied for a good year this year. There will be a one-minute penalty, even though the goal was scored on the slashing call. So Virginia, just two bits of good news. They tie the game, and now they have their second man-up opportunity.
It makes the face-off extra important, because if they lose the face-off, they lose the extra man possibility.
One-minute penalty. It was called on McCambridge. So Virginia trying to cash in twice here on that mistake.
All six Virginia attackmen stacked in front of the goal, what we call 3-3. That defense packed in there tight, not wanting to get them a good shot. They want to go ahead and move the ball around, look for a high percentage shot out front.
Rich Rita, we have 58 seconds to go in the quarter for Marino. They haven't taken a shot yet on this man-up opportunity. They're 0-for-1 so far in those situations. The Cavaliers are. Nicholas, dangerous man. Nice save by Ayburn. 40 seconds to play in the third quarter. Marino runs it down, and Virginia has another shot. They're almost set to release that man from the penalty area.
Penalty's over now. Even up one last shot, and it didn't quite work.
Marino's shot was stuffed by Ayburn. And scorched. North Carolina's defender went down to his knees.
The call is a moving pick call. Ayburn got the ball in his stick. The defender came in to try to protect Ayburn. He knocked down the Virginia player. They call that a moving pick. The possession will go back to Virginia.
Just possession, though. No man down situation.
No man down. It'll be even up. But possession with a tie game, as we all know, yeah, pretty important.
And late in the third quarter, of course, critical. Willie Scroggs is not going to be happy. Let's check out the moving pick.
Right there, when a man has the ball, goalie or not, you cannot go ahead and pick a man off.
There's a goal with 13 seconds to go in the quarter. Roddy Marino walked around the defense of Chris Walker there. And Virginia, on Marino's second goal of the game, he now has 4 points on the day, has retaken an 8-7 lead.
Roddy Marino is very quick. He comes along against Walker. This power move was very successful against Syracuse. He is 6'1", about 190 pounds, very strong. And Marino is the guy they look for to be the catalyst for that offense. Right then, he just took a big jump on Walker with about 14 seconds left. He wanted to get a good shot off. Lunged in front of the goal, shot low against Abram, which seems to be working today. And now, a goal advantage.
He's got 34 on the year, as you saw. Just two away from tying a club record. Also has 97 career goals, Roddy Marino does. And that last one will... That'll tear your heart out to get a goal that scored that late in a quarter after a situation gave the ball back to Virginia. Sprague cannot be happy with the last couple of minutes of action here in the third quarter. His team has now fallen behind here in the title game against his conference opponents all year long, Virginia. I think Rita stepped out of bounds, far sideline. Ball goes back to North Carolina. Rita was being bumped all the way up the field there by number 17, Kevin Hawes, the younger brother of Tom. And...
See Ace Adams calling out direction from the defense. He doesn't want a cheap shot here that would result in an easy goal. With only 6 seconds left, just drop back. Don't give him an easy shot.
They'll go for the long downfield pass and just try to get it. Here they come. Big shot by Howes. Skips over the end line with 1 second to play. So we have one more tick left on this third quarter clock. There was a shot, of course, so North Carolina will be able to inbound the ball in the person of Gary Seibold behind the net. They're going to put Scott Lind right up on him. Got to pass that thing right in front and just shoot it immediately. There goes the pass, and the horn sounds. Level zero jump on the board. The third quarter is over. We are all set for a tremendous last quarter of play. After three, it is Virginia leading North Carolina by one.
When I was growing up, I didn't spend all my time playing tennis. I also had my share of chores, like washing the family car. Now I'm breaking in my replacement. Kids today don't really realize how easy they've got it. You see, we have a Jet-X.
Yes, superior technology has created the Jet-X Power Spray Washer. It accelerates water to 20 times its normal speed to wash away dirt and grime in minutes. Even second-story windows become beautifully clean. Use this fan tip to power spray your car with Jet-X Super Concentrated Suds, then rinse away road dirt and grime. And right now, Jet-X can save you money. Look for this $3 factory rebate on the package or wherever Jet-X is sold.
It does all that and more, so take it from a pro. Get a Jet-X. Now I can spend all my time playing tennis.
Spray wash like a pro with the Jet-X Power Spray Washer.
Get a $3 factory rebate on the Jet-X Power Spray Washer. Look for this product at these fine stores.
The athlete's foot can fit you with a shoe that fits the way you run. Like the Pegasus GX, the most popular Nike running shoe ever. Or the Venue, one of Nike's most technically advanced models. And now, we offer the Windrunner, new from Nike, but already developing a loyal following. Join the Nike Spring Trials at the Athlete's Foot and get fit right, because nobody knows the athlete's foot like the athlete's foot.
We've come down to one quarter to decide the national title list this year. We were 1-1 after one. It was 5-4 North Carolina after two, and now as we enter the third quarter, or the fourth quarter, I should say, Virginia leads by one, and Virginia just dominated play. Look at that face-off stat right there. North Carolina has not won a single face-off this entire half, the third quarter. The man responsible, Brad Wood, number 26 in orange right there.
Well, I tell you, we saw North Carolina not do much of anything against Hopkins in the third quarter of their game. Didn't quite matter. They're still in the game. They can still win it. So you can throw away that third quarter statistic because it's a one-goal game. Anybody can win it.
They're still battling for this face-off. It's a big one. And it's picked up by Virginia. And taken right back by Carolina. Seibold nailed Nicklaus from behind. A couple of good attack men meeting up there at the midfield area. Gary Seibold, his team down by one.
These two teams met earlier in the season. The final score was 11-9 in favor of Virginia. We're right about on target for that same score.
And that game was at Chapel Hill, a big win for the Cavaliers. Seibold spins, bodied by two, keeps coming like a pinball. Now a flag goes down. Shot goes, and they score. Just kept on coming. Kent Brown was bodied, fouled, shot anyway, and he beat Sheehan to tie the game up.
Brad Wood is beside himself. He's holding his helmet. He can't stand the thought that the team let down. The foul is one thing, But the fact that he let play stop almost, watch Brad Wood. He's used to coming out of the game after the faceoff. He's stuck in here playing defense. There's an obvious hold. Now watch the defense kind of relax. They sort of relax. They see the flags down, and the shot comes off. It's like a good player should. He continues with the play, gets a good shot off. Sheehan, seemingly asleep on the play, lets an easy shot go in. He makes a spectacular save. A lot of good shots going in on him. Right now, we're going to have our sixth tie of the game with only a quarter to go.
Boy, this is a good one. Everything we thought it would be. That flag went down would have been a 30-second penalty against Wood, so it will not be served. We are even up, both on the field in men and on the board in goals, eight apiece. North Carolina finally wins the faceoff in this second half. Long pass by Howes, right to Storch with a big stick. He makes it. Now he'll run back into the defensive end. They'll bring the attack people down and go at him again. We've played a minute and 20 in the final 15 minutes.
Carolina again playing not much of a third quarter, but you can forget about it. The game is so close that it doesn't matter. They've gotten away with it twice. They got away with that against Johns Hopkins. They're getting away with it against the Virginia team today.
Virginia came in today a 9-game win streak, 12-2 overall record. And Carolina, who lost their last regular season game, came in at 10-3. Behind the net it goes. Crawford, good move, shoots and scores. Rick Crawford gets his first goal of the game, and it's a big one. This team now retakes a 9-8 lead.
Looks like Virginia was in a zone defense, and that was the mistake that Scott Lynn made of not pinching. Look at the zone staying there. Scott Lynn doesn't pinch close enough. Crawford pulls the stick, comes in close enough to get a shot in on Sheehan. Again, in a zone defense, you cannot give him that inside seam. You make him shoot from the outside. Scott Lynn misjudged it a little bit, and Crawford took advantage of it. Nice move by Crawford. Tucked the stick, had a little bit of room left, took a nice shot against Sheehan.
So they play ping pong with the lead again. Fourth time now, Carolina's on top. Nice play by Crawford. He scored a couple of goals in the semifinal win against Hopkins, and that's his first of the day right there. Another big faceoff coming up against Brad Wood. It'll be this time Robbie Russell, not Ted Brown. Wood has faced off exclusively for Jim Adams, and Willie Scroggs has shuffled up his faceoff men using Brown and Russell. This time Russell, we'll see what happens. Wood's like a bull the way he buries his head in the back of the defender. Russell using the stick, had it, lost it, taken down by Virginia. Nice action there. David Gatton grabbed it. And now Virginia looking for the equalizer. That's Nicholas.
Slows play down while his offensive midfield comes into play. The faceoff unit goes off, and now they're back in full strength for offense.
As he has all day, Tom Howes will watch Nicholas. Bumps him. Nicholas gives it up. Pass went inside. It was dropped, though, there by Ed Hardy. What a blast there.
Was a tough hit by Kevin Howes. Kevin Howes came and got the Virginia player going right against the grain, and that was a legal hit. It was in 5 yards of the ball if the feed came in.
Ultimus now for Virginia. He wings it up top of the box. This is Rich Rita spinning. Lost his footing. It was stolen, but Rita was able to scrap for it, and we have a whistle and a warning off call against Rita.
Watch this hit coming into the crease. Nicholas gets the ball. Kevin Howes anticipated beautifully that the feed was coming in there. Nicholas looking for the seam. Nicholas had to look away from the goal to get that feed. And Kevin Howes timed it perfectly, met the player right when the ball got there. Perfectly legal hit. And luckily, Nicholas is still standing up. Ball going to North Carolina.
Boy, he hits like his big brother does. They kill each other.
Here again, they're letting the goalie, Abern, come up uncontested. And the mystery to me is that they don't cover anybody else that closely.
Well, they have had no problem when Abern's wandered from the crease and clearing the ball.
That's a common riding technique, but what you normally do is cover everybody else so closely that he has no option.
11:38 to go on this one. Gary Seifold. His team leading by one goal. Well, I feel safe in saying it will not be a 9-8 final. These two teams have got a lot of energy left. This is Jimmy Kester. He's met nicely there by the defense of Mike Meyer. Crawford. Left side it goes for Seibold. Watched by Lynn. Lynn whacks him a couple of times. Seibold, the little guy, backs away.
Virginia looking to get a spark. They might need to get it from their defense again and see if Beezer can pick up the slack.
Hester dropped the ball after being nailed by Meyer, and Meyer picks it up. Great defense there by the Cavaliers. That's been their strength all year long. Last line of their defense, Sheehan. Little wing around the rosy here as they chase it around the tree.
Carolina, much tougher team to clear against than Virginia. Virginia seems to be going ahead and giving them the clear when North Carolina has the ball, but North Carolina is actually riding very hard, making it tough for Virginia to clear the ball, and that takes its toll on your players. They expend a lot of energy getting the ball just to their offensive half of the field.
Now it's Carolina's turn to play a little defense here, try and shut down the Cavaliers. Played almost 5 minutes now in this final quarter of action.
Here comes that pick play. They're trying to set up that pick behind the goal. You saw Nicholas try to set up a nice pick right on the point.
And then that's got it out, looks like, Leaf. They set it down every time. Nice pass inside. Shot was weak. Rita was bumped down. Here comes Carolina. Storch to Mike Tomillo. And now back away. 9:50 to play.
North Carolina has that goal lead. They're not going to make any stupid mistake by throwing the ball away. They'll settle it down, look to get a high percentage shot. Every goal is so important here in the fourth quarter.
Well, Dan Smith made the fourth quarter's offense in basketball famous at Chapel Hill in a slim lead game. We'll see if Scroggs takes the tempo down a notch.
Well, lacrosse tried to eliminate that by making that box area that you see there. They'll have to get it in play, keep it in play, and make a move toward the goal.
Brett Davey shoots. Nice save by Sheehan. Ball scooped up by the aggressive Tar Heels, though. Robbie Russell grabbed it. Clock now becomes the ally, at least for now, of North Carolina. 9:09 to go. They lead by just one. Seibold lost it. Lynn rammed him, but Seibold graveled the ball back up.
Seibold looking for a call there. He had a lot of contact up around his helmet area, and he looked right to the referee. Referee called it a brush.
Robbie Russell shoots. Good bounce, but he let it go weakly. Seibold grabs it, though, to his knees and right back up on his feet. What an athlete he is.
Very difficult to get the ball away from Gary Seibold.
Red Davey weaves his way in, shoots, and Sheehan made the save, and right on the doorstep, he made another save, and they stepped inside the crease. 8:36 to play. Final quarter, Tar Heels by one.
Each day, an awful lot of paper lands on your desk. So should the Wall Street Journal. After all, information is in power. Knowing where to find it is.
Call 800-372-3000 for this special introductory offer. 13 weeks for just $29.50 with a money-back guarantee. 13 weeks, $29.50. Phone 800-372-3000 now for the Wall Street Journal.
When furniture has layers of ugly paint, use Formby's Paint Remover. But for old varnish, use Formby's Furniture Refinisher. An independent lab proved my paint remover is more powerful than other well-known brands, yet it won't raise the grain. Formby's Furniture Refinisher uses my special method to dissolve the ruined finish and reveal the wood's hidden beauty. So for paint, Formby's Paint Remover. And for varnish, Formby's Furniture Refinisher. For great results and guaranteed satisfaction, remember, there's only one home.
8.5 minutes to go to decide the national champion. For the moment, Carolina hanging on to a one-goal lead. We've played seesaw with the lead all day long, though. 52.
Calling out 52, trying to get a different clearing situation going as Virginia shuffles their players around. North Carolina putting a lot of heat on the ride, and that could end up being a big plus for them here late in the game.
Now Chris Walker, the defenseman, trying to clear it here. Ultimus had it. He wiggled his way through two sticks. Goes for Roddy Marino. Cavalier fans have made the trek down from Charlottesville, trying to get their attack people pumped up. Marino for Nicholas. Flag goes down.
Free shot coming up. They got to get a shot off. It's a free one.
Flags on Carolina. Rita, or pardon me, Ultimus, and it was stopped nicely by Ayburn. We had an offsides call. Looked like against North Carolina. CFA College football is coming up on ESPN. The best brand of football in the nation can be seen only here when the top teams from the College Football Association are showcased on ESPN. Coverage kicks off Saturday, August the 30th, with Miami taking on South Carolina. Actually, a foul was called on Tomillo of North Carolina as he was offside. Ball goes back to Virginia, trying to tie the game up.
Virginia has not scored in the extra man situations. North Carolina is scoring twice on them, so it has made a big impact on the game.
Virginia's 0 for 2 in their man-ups. Ultimus wings it across the field. Engelke gave up the shot. Rita blasted it. Aburn's equal to it. He's going to wander away. They're going to nail him. And not much of a check there as Auburn able to elude Ultimus. Now trying to kill some time. As Kevin Howes wings it back to Walker across midfield, it goes. We are even once again. And Virginia now is 0 for 3 in their man-ups.
Offside, looks like a push call on Blue. It's a great play by Beezer. Beezer came in from the actual substitution box. Watch Beezer coming in, lunges in for the ball, and they're calling Tomillo for hitting him from behind, actually. It's a push. The ball go over to Virginia, but an excellent hustling play by number 12 right there, Beezer, who came flying in from the substitution box, immediately involving himself in the play.
So Tomillo commits two infractions in about 30 seconds. Ball goes back over to the Virginia Cavaliers. And at this stage, they need it. They're down by one. Less than 7 minutes to play in the final quarter of regulation. Nice spin. Ball goes over to Rita. That was number 36 making a spin. David Smith, haven't seen much of him today. Now Rita, he's being watched by Harry McCambridge.
Double teamed, he tucks beautifully.
Great pass. Smith had a shot, waited too long. The defense collapsed on him. Kurt Storch. Nice pass by Smith, though, and the shot went wide. Nicholas shoots, just wide. Walker's on it for Carolina. They nail him. Marino hit him. And Marino grabs the loose ball. Number six, pass out in front. Tipped nicely by McCambridge, right to his goalkeeper, Aburn.
Tough luck for the Cavaliers. They had a lot of good hustling plays there. Couldn't quite get a good shot off.
6:06 to play. Carolina by one. Now a couple of them bang. Tomillo spins on it, goes inside. Seibold, nice save by Sheehan as he went down low. And I believe we have a goal-free violation on Seibold. The momentum carried him in. And he's got to be shaking his head. Sheehan made some save.
Outstanding plays on both ends of the field. Virginia had a couple opportunities down there to get a good shot off. They couldn't quite pull it off because Carolina was cutting down those low-percentage passes that always look dramatic when they work. If they don't work, it's good defense. I'm right down the field. Seibold had a one-on-one. He's so good at that, it's scary. But he came in, and Sheehan, maybe the best goalie in the game, turned him away.
We have Sheehan, Leaf, unofficially for 16 saves now.
That's a healthy
amount. Whole bunch.
That's absolutely correct. He's been busy down there. There you
and
go. There's
Seibold.
The foot on the crease for the call. Seibold trying to dance around the white area there. Didn't quite make it. Ball going over to Virginia.
And they now come across midfield. Tom Engelke.
Time clicking away there, Greg.
Yep, it's getting late. 5.5 to go. Maybe it will end 9-8. Who knows? Virginia certainly hopes it will not, though. And Nicholas, a great attack man, going to try and tie this thing up.
Well, watch
it goes for John Gillett.
The defense for Carolina staying in a man-to-man.
Gillett now watched by Kevin House. They have two of them out there, Kevin. And also on the defense is Tom. Roddy Marino. We have 5 minutes to play in this game. Marino on Chris Walker, drops the ball, picks it back up. Now Marino going to jog behind the net, try and come again. Left side, bumped by two players. Pass never handled. Taken away by Carolina. Rosegrove bumps a player. Taken away by Carolina, though. Brett Davey, the midfielder for the Tar Heels. He goes for Rich Crawford. 4.5 to play now in the game.
Well, you wanted to see the four corners? We'll show you how close they can get to it in lacrosse. They're going to slow the ball down a little bit. Maybe not. Welsh has it.
Now Pat Welsh. Double team. Gets hammered. Still has an open hand, though, and he keeps possession. Lobs it far right side of the box for Crawford. Now left side, near sideline for Seibold. Watched by Lynn. He throws it for Mike Tomillo. Pat Welsh now. Being watched by Gillen, number 32, Gillen. Welsh, he's dangerous in this area with those bounce shots, but he backs away. They're in no hurry. 3:55 to play. West Virginia in the man-to-man cannot waste much time. Davies shoots. Never got through. This ball, a dangerous one. Picked up by Carolina. They're one step ahead of them.
Carolina content to slow it down. They'll get a shot off here and there. The most important thing is not only getting a good shot, but backing it up and keeping possession.
They're killing the clock, too, as Welsh's shot was stuffed nicely by Rosebro, but Tomillo grabs the all-important ground ball. And, hey, we only have 3:23 to play in this game. 9-8, Carolina. They've not won the title in lacrosse, men's lacrosse Division I, since 82. They won it two straight years, then 81 and 82 under Willie Scroggs. Look at Crawford gobble up the turf here, just jogging around.
Everybody yelling about the stalling. Yeah, the referee signals you've got to go toward the goal. Here could be a fast break for Virginia if they get on their feet here.
Breyer made a great play, then a bad pass. Walker nails the man. Ted Brown picks it up. Look at this action. It's all coming right down to this action here. Welsh. We have a whistle now. Timeout called by North Carolina.
Excellent call by Willie Scroggs.
Well, 2:43 will decide this thing. We're going to come back and give you the national champion in a moment.
ESPN's America's Cup update is brought to you by Cadillac, America's luxury car leader. With red, white, and blue, the colors of choice, 5,000 gathered to cheer the New York Yacht Club's christening of US 46, the latest and final 12-meter for America, too. With helmsman John Coleus, US 46 is en route to Fremantle this month to join her sisters, US 42 and 44. America 2 is counting on US 46 to be at least an even match for Alan Bond's Australia 4, now under construction.
Announcing the classic Cadillac for 1986, the rear-wheel drive Fleetwood Brougham. Styling that's every inch a Cadillac. Inches that add up to the longest regular production car. Plus full-size comfort for six adults and their luggage. And new for Brougham, a powerful 5-liter V8. If you think big, think about the new 1986 Brougham.
Now available with 6.9% GMAC financing. Length of finance contract is limited.
Watch Nesbitt and Company, compelling conversations with today's corporate leaders. An exclusive series on Nation's Business Today. Weekday mornings on ESPN.
We're back in Newark, Delaware. Delaware Stadium. Greg Pop alongside Leif Elsmo. And Leif, we have just seen some tremendous lacrosse this first Final Four weekend ever in the nation's first state. It's all been competitive, very close. And right now, it's the outcome of this game is a long way away.
Every sport championship looks for parity. They look for good competition. And you couldn't have better competition. And this Final Four format has proven for lacrosse in its first year. Ace Adams gets his team out. Let me tell you, one goal is not anywhere near a comfortable lead. Carolina has the ball. They've got the clock on their side, but one goal can be scored. Let me tell you, Virginia scored one goal in 5 seconds when they had the ball out of bounds earlier this year to beat a University of Maryland team. So, a lot of time left.
Just a gorgeous weekend all the way around here in Newark, Delaware. The weather has been fabulous. High into the 70s and 80s, low humidity, perfect action. And the folks here at the University of Delaware have done an outstanding job in hosting this tournament for a second season. They also did it back in 1984.
Any surprise that Willie Scroggs has the ball in Gary Seibold's hand? He wants him to eat up as much of that clock as possible. Very difficult to get the ball away from Gary Seibold.
And if I was coaching, I'd give it to him, too. Just let him run this thing out or as near as he can do it. That clock you're looking at is the game clock. Seibold, good burst of speed, never shot it though, as he had a bad angle on Sheehan.
Got a bad angle also, he wants to maintain possession. That's more important right now than getting another goal.
Russell shoots, Sheehan, maybe a game-saving save right there. Loose ball, squirts out, whistle. Push is called on Carolina.
Ball going over to Virginia, and these calls are also very important. The referee calling a push against Carolina. Virginia's ball, they only need one good shot, one good score to lock it up.
Scott Lynn picks himself up, as he was a big man in that sequence right there to grab the ball. Scott Lynn did not attend the University of Virginia last year. Academically ineligible.
Here's that ground ball situation, Greg, and look at the sticks flying, but Carolina came flying through with some good hustle. That was actually a push because it was from behind, and the good hustle represents itself in, against Crawford, actually, it was called, represents in a pushing violation, ball going back to Virginia.
Well, we've come down to this. And Virginia has got to come right now.
We talked about the excellent hustling ride that UNC has been imposing against Virginia, and it worked right here.
Here's Rita now. Exactly a minute and a half to go, as you can see. Ted Brown is watching behind the net.
Engelke set up to go one-on-one in an inverted situation. He's going against a short stick midi. They want him to get a shot.
He gets the step on Brown, comes around, spins, shoots high. But Nicklaus is in a race with Howes. Nicklaus won the race. It's going to remain
smokes.
Virginia's ball. The crowd here, the Carolina people, thought it was Howes who outbeat him. And from this vantage point, Leif, I thought he did too.
Well, he thinks he did. Absolutely. Howes was absolutely putting his hand up in triumph. He beat the man to the line, but the referee behind his back was calling Virginia ball.
That's
here it is.
It.
You
he's
make up your
step.
Own mind right
yeah,
there. Look at Howes. He probably had
ball.
It. Meanwhile,
it's a goal. Back live action. Will Roseboro broke in and ties the game. How do you like that? Very controversial.
What a
big
game.
Possession goes over to Virginia, and they cash in immediately as we get a chance to see Roseboro right here finish it off.
Here it is. Just a power move that Virginia's been imploring all day long. Look at that. He comes in with a nice bounce shot out in front of Ahern. Very tough to read on this surface. And while North Carolina was in their mind trying to justify the call by the referee, Virginia took the opportunity in hand, went right to the cooker. Roseboro bounced in a nice shot to tie it up.
Wow. So the first 58 minutes and 55 seconds essentially mean nothing. We are dead even with 65 seconds to play. And Jim Ace Adams now, along with his coaching staff, has had a lot to think about. We're going to come back here in a moment and give you the conclusion. 65 seconds left.
Well, somebody's happy to be going to work.
I love my job.
I wish I could say that.
Bob.
I know. Look for a better job in the National Business Employment Weekly.
See? The best jobs available everywhere in the country. Professional, managerial, technical, that's you, at top companies.
Nice salaries.
$25,000 a year and up. There are articles to help you land a better job, how to look good in interviews, write a better resume, and the reason I still read it, articles to help you do better on the job. How to handle office politics, when to ask for a raise, how to deal with an impossible boss.
Okay, I'm convinced. I'm a National Business Employment Weekly reader.
Don't make a career move without it.
Ask for the National Business Employment Weekly at your newsstand, or if you prefer, get the next 8 issues by first-class mail for $35. Call toll-free 800-228-5505. 8 weekly issues, $35. Call 800-228-5505 now.
Here's the equalizer, Lee. Will Roseboro.
Roseboro very strong, going for his right hand. He's double-teamed by North Carolina. It didn't make any difference. He got a hard right-hand shot off, and on this uneven turf at Delaware Stadium, it took a nice hard bounce underneath the pipe. Barney Ahern had little or no chance to stop that one. Tie game, minute to go.
Everybody's up on their feet here. They're just applauding the action. I mean, this has been just tremendous, and we've had the privilege here at ESPN to bring you two tremendously close games. Our first one, the semifinal game, went to overtime, and we're staring OT right in the eye again.
Greg, we've got about 15,000 some fans here chanting UVA, chanting Carolina. What a great way to end the first final format ever for Division I lacrosse.
Here is an absolutely crucial face-off. Wood against Russell. Wood scores the Carolina end. And it's picked up by Wood, the face-off man. Boy, he's something else. And Virginia now, with less than a minute to go, will try and play for the national championship.
Ace Adams calling a timeout, trying to get his last offense going. He'd like to end it right here. He doesn't want overtime. He's got the ball. It's in his court.
Well, it's come down to this. We have just 54 seconds to play. The Virginia Cavaliers, who have finished up as the bridesmaids back in 1980 under Ace Adams. They haven't won a national championship since 1972, when they beat Johns Hopkins. And to the folks back in Charlottesville, Leif, it Seems like a long, long time.
Oh, it's been a long time. 1972 had the great attack duo of Tom Duquette and Jay Connor. The best player in the country that year. This team is a defensive team. Sheehan got him there. The defense got him there. Guys like Beezer coming out from the defensive end and scoring goals like he did in the first half. Nevertheless, every game they've been in it because of that defense. Here they are, 9-9, just where they want to be. A controlled offense for another minute. Get a good shot off. Take it home. Forget about overtime. That's Ace Adams' strategy. This call, actually, right here, as we look at the Tommy Hall's running out, and very obviously from this camera angle, and again, the referee was much closer than us. We cannot judge it from there. It looked to be Tom Hall's ball. He was raising his hand in triumph. Meanwhile, the referee was pointing the other direction, and inside of 10 seconds from that very moment, Virginia ties the game.
Well, they're going to talk about that one if Virginia goes on and wins this thing. Certainly that call is going to be critical.
Let's check the personnel for Virginia. You've got Tom Engelke's midfield in there, along with Rich Rita, two of their best middies. Of course, the attack.
The ball right there, Leaf, the guy who tied the game, Jeff Nicklaus, number 10. And they're going to try and play for one last flurry on Barney Ayburn.
I don't think the goal right now
could mean the title.
They'll wait, just as you might imagine in basketball, they'll wait. They'll try to get the clock working for them, get down around 20 seconds or less, maybe 15 seconds, get a shot, leave North Carolina no time.
And leave themselves enough time to try and grab a rebound and stuff it back in. This is Rosebro.
He's checking the clock.
It's winding down. They got to come at him.
It's Engelke, one-on-one, the last move. Nope, back to Nicklaus. 12 seconds.
Well, they want this situation. We have 8 seconds left. Nicklaus now. Spinning. At a tough angle, three, fires, and wide. 1 second to go, and the final second did fire off. We have finished up regulation. We are going to overtime. So the next goal will decide the 1986 NCAA Division I national champion.
Premium taste and a less filling beer.
Michelob Light, oh yes you can. Have it all.
You won't believe what's happening inside your muffler. Rust that starts on the inside is eating its way through. The Napa Advantage muffler with Absorbite helps prevent internal rust. The inside of this muffler was not protected with Absorbite. This muffler was. You can see the difference. The Napa Advantage is even covered by a lifetime warranty. Of course, you may never have to use it. The Napa Advantage. It puts rust at a disadvantage. Available at thousands of Napa outlets.
Presenting the Fortrax 200SX from Honda. It's so much fun. Some people can't wait to ride one. The Fortrax 200SX from Honda. More fun than you've ever dreamed of.
Let's face it, I have a big appetite for life, and I don't want anyone telling me how to live it. The world is my oyster. That's why I carry MasterCard. It opens up all the possibilities and puts me in the driver's seat. Imagine all of life's possibilities with the great one at the wheel.
No, Katsa.
Thank you. MasterCard. Oh, sweet it is. MasterCard. Master the possibilities.
These players have to be tired. They played their semifinal game just 2 days ago, but nobody is going to lack any desire or hustle now. The whole season is riding on the winner of the next goal scorer. It's going to do it all right here. And this is the fourth time in the history of this championship, this being the 16th year of the tournament format, that one goal will decide the outcome. And this face-off, as they all are, critical. Brad Wood will face it off for Virginia. Number 32, Robbie Russell, will do it for North Carolina.
2 days ago, North Carolina was in the same situation against Hopkins, and they did pretty well. I get the feeling that Virginia might be a little more nervous. Warding off, that's going to be Brad Wood pushing with his offhand. North Carolina has the ball.
Now, generally, you don't see a whole lot of tight calls at this stage of the game. And Brad Wood he's a little upset. He's played great as far as face-offs all year long. But that time it is Hastings. Pick up a big loose ball. He gives North Carolina the first shot to win the championship. Ace Adams directs his troops. He's a low-key guy usually, but he's pumped up right now.
Robbie Russell against Meyer. Meyer having the short stick. Russell may try to take advantage of that.
Here's Russell. Shoots. Up top, Avern. Sheehan made a tremendous save there. He almost dropped it in his net, though.
Here comes Beezer. Beezer, the big stick. Can he do it for the title? The pass.
And it was smothered from behind. Good Carolina defense there.
Absolutely textbook. Beezer had the fast break. He elected to go for a feed.
Now Seibel to Brett Davey. Davey dropped it. Boy, these two teams are going at it right away. They want to end it. Tamillo, the hero of the semifinal Carolina win. Full head of steam.
Boy, we almost ended that baby real quick. Both ends of the field getting a good shot off. Sheehan coming up with a save. And then the other end of the field, the defense getting off a nice check.
There's Russell again. Good first step. Shoots. Sheehan. Actually, saved the title right there with a great save.
Sound like a pipe shot, really, Greg. Sound like it was on the pipe. That'll be offside. Ball going to Virginia.
Howes pushed Nicklaus across the midfield line. And they call that on North Carolina. So Virginia now, after weathering a couple of storms on Sheehan, will try and come down and see if they can pepper away at Barney Avern.
Beezer had a shot. He came down. He elected to go for the feed on his fast break. He wishes he had that back because he was very close and had a good velocity if he would have gone ahead with that long stick and taken a shot. But now Roseboro sets up the offense.
Here comes Virginia. They haven't won the national title in 14 years. Roseboro. Engelke, he quarterbacks their attack. Up top, fires. Avern got it. Loose ball picked up by Howes. Threw it a little long. Big body check and a whistle. Push is called on Virginia. Ball goes back to North Carolina.
I hate to see the referees take charge of the game. You're seeing a lot of good contact. They have to make the call if they see it, but it's pretty tough in every loose ball situation. The referee is calling a push now and giving possession that may be critical to one team or the other. Let's make up our own mind right here as the loose ball is on the ground from behind. There is a collision of sorts called push by the referee as Tamillo goes flying across the midfield stripe. A lot of contact. Every possession, the most critical of the game so far.
Scott Lind was the guilty party on that infraction. Ball goes back to North Carolina. This is Brett Davey.
Brett Davey, somebody we haven't heard from too much in this whole series, and he is an excellent offensive threat.
Trying to weave his way in for a shot. They stop the play, though, when he goes far sideline for Crawford. Now behind the net for Gary Seibel. What a year has he had. What a way to cap it off. Shoot, scores! It's all over. North Carolina has won the NCAA lacrosse championship with 2:10 to go in OT. Gary Seibel.
Fitting
that he did it.
Absolutely fitting. Gary Seibel, small in stature, big in talent. Here's a guy who carried his team 5'7", 155 pounds. Not flashy one-on-one, but boy, you give him an inch, he'll take a mile. And right there, he knew the game was on the line. He said, give me the ball. And he took the impetus to go in here and get a great shot off.
What a season it has been for the Tar Heels. They have overcome injury, all kinds of adversity. But Willie Scruggs, right there, wins his third title, and for the second time in Virginia, Ace Adams is a bridesmaid.
North Carolina had to beat every team that beat them in the regular season to be where they are at this moment, and they did it. Unheard of, maybe unprecedented. And let's take a look at that last goal by Seibel. Look at him right here. He sets up, he surveys the field. Little juke there to the left, drives to the right hand. Now he has a step against his defenseman. That's all he wants. To wait for the moment, he goes high and shoots where he knows that crossbeam is, 6 feet high. He brings it about 5 feet 11. It's a goal for the national championship.
Willie Scruggs has his team the champions, third time in the decade of the 80s. Only Johns Hopkins can boast that. North Carolina wins it in overtime. Final score is 10-9. We're back in a moment to talk to the champions right after this.
Playing Major League Baseball keeps me pretty busy. Even when I'm not in the action, I keep up with the action. That's why I read the Sporting News. Nobody gets you into the game like the Sporting News. The ins, the outs, who's hot at the plate, who's swinging like a rusty gate, who's breaking, who's aching, and which teams are shaking it up around the league. More baseball coverage than your local paper and all other sports weeklies and monthlies combined. I'm serious about sports, and that's why I read the sporting news. And here's how you can save some serious money when you sign on for a special half-price offer now.
You'll get 36 issues of the Sporting News for one-half the regular subscription price. You'll also get the football and basketball preview issues at no extra cost. All for three easy installments of only $5.99. So call now, toll-free, 1-800-592-6000.
The Sporting News, it's terrific.
Well, they overcame adversity all year long. They had overcome all kinds of obstacles, but North Carolina are the national champions this year. Joining me, their head coach, Willie Scroggs, and Gary Seifold, who did not get a whole lot of ink yesterday on the great move you made. Tomillo kind of stole it, or actually in the semifinal game 2 days ago, but today they grabbed the game winner for the whole marbles.
Yeah, Peter Sheehan been stopping me low all day. Coach Scroggs was telling me to go high. I beat my defenseman, and I got a good shot off, and thank God it went in.
It seems both teams' philosophy to come out in the overtime was just go at it, try and stuff it in early, and just get it over with.
Yeah, I mean, that's the way we play, you know. We have a break, we'll go for it. Our best opportunities come off ground balls, you know, scramble situations, and that's what we try to do in the overtime.
There's a look at the goal coming up for you, although we're having a tough time seeing it on the monitor. It was simply a case of you using your good speed, as you have all year long.
I had a good quick move. I had him by just a step. He's a real strong defenseman. He's big. He's tough to shoot over. And I just got a good shot off.
Talk about you filling in for your brother, losing him so early in the year, and what he meant to you, and how you just filled his shoes so well.
Well, he means everything to the whole team. You know, we missed him for a long time afterwards. It took us a while to find players who would fill the gaps that Joey left. People like Pat Welsh, James Kester, Richard Crawford, who came in really strong at the end of the season and through this playoffs really made the team.
Gary Seifel, North Carolina, their head coach now, Willie Scroggs. Willie, first two times you won the title, you went through the season unblemished, racked up 26 straight. Is this one more satisfying, considering you lost three games, lost some big people to injury?
I think it's a good indication of what can happen in a tournament situation. We tell the guys, whether we're the top-ranked team or the last-ranked team, that if you can get in the thing, you can win it if you play well. And we played every game one at a time, and we didn't look past anybody. And it was a tough, hard-fought ball game today, and the semifinals and the opening round games were. And I'm just real pleased our kids just hung in there all through the tournament.
Was there anything about the game today that surprised you? It seemed the physicalness came out early, and it kept up all day long.
We played Virginia a lot over the years. We know they're a big, tough team. Nothing surprised me. We knew it was going to be a hard-fought ball game. We were hoping it would be a hard-fought ball game. We wanted to get more opportunities to score, but you don't normally get those against Virginia.
North Carolina was seeded number 5 in this year's tournament. They had to beat three teams that beat them during the regular season in the tournament, and they did it all. And one for Coach Scroggs, his third NCAA championship by a score of 10-9. We're back in a moment, Leif Elsmo and I, to recap this exciting day of overtime action in a moment.
When furniture has layers of ugly paint, use Formby's paint remover. But for old varnish, use Formby's furniture refinisher. An independent lab proved my paint remover is more powerful than other well-known brands, yet it won't raise the grain. Formby's furniture refinisher uses my special method to dissolve the ruined finish and reveal the wood's hidden beauty. So for paint, Formby's paint remover. And for varnish, Formby's furniture refinisher. For great results and guaranteed satisfaction, remember, there's only one Homer Formby.
Even more than the savings on commissions that we provide investors, we give them a haven where they can conduct their business without all of the hassles and the opinions and pressures from salespeople. We have offices in all the major cities in the United States, some 93. On top of that, we offer a 24-hour, 7-day-a-week service so you can always reach us.
Save on commissions. Call Charles Schwab for this free booklet, 800-255-5000. That's 800-255-5000.
Well, Leif, the folks down in Chapel Hill don't like doing things the easy way. Two overtime thrillers, and they're the champions.
That's absolutely incredible. It's great for lacrosse. The first Final Four format, and here's the parity that the league exhibits. The team comes in here ranked 5th. It's the first time Hopkins hasn't been here in a long time. They beat three teams they had to beat or lost to during the season, and they did it with a nice, balanced team. It was a 10-man effort, and that's great for lacrosse because that's what it's all about. It's a good transition game. It's a game that takes 10 players to play. Carolina has to be very proud. And Gary Seifel, the guy that was the backbone of that team, all the way through the playoffs, wins it in overtime. Couldn't be any better.
All right, so North Carolina, for the third time in the decade of the 80s, are the NCAA lacrosse national champions. They needed two overtimes this weekend to do it. They beat Johns Hopkins, knocked them out, then today took out the third-seeded Virginia Cavaliers. The final overtime today, 10-9, North Carolina and Gary Seibold's goal. For Leif Elsmo, I'm Greg Poppin. For the entire ESPN crew, we bid you so long from Delaware Stadium in Newark, Delaware.
Nobody has lower fares.